to reputations, this man's is second to none. Regarded as one of the most feared men in the northeast of England. He terrified Teesside as a debt collector, henchman, enforcer. Also known for his take-no-bullshit attitude in the prison system. A rumour once said he broke into a prison to settle a dispute with an inmate. And for the first time ever, he tells his incredible story on a Davy Robson podcast. Welcome to another episode of Davy Robson's podcast. Thanks everyone for subscribing and your thumbs up and everything, it means a lot. My next guest is Paul Pounder, aka The Vulture. And thanks for coming on, my mate.
No worries, pal.
Good to see you.
Good to see you, mate. It's a pleasure.
Right, before I start, I've got to mention this feedback I've had on this episode. It's unreal.
I've been watching it, and I'm thinking, see, I don't know what, you know.
Yeah.
I've never done a podcast, I've never told the story, so when you go, oh, it's flying up, I'm like, well, is it?
It is, honestly, that my phone has never stopped since your name got mentioned. So what I'm going to do, Vulture, we'll start off like this. I know you've been a bouncer, a debt collector, prison, bits and bobs, lived a mental life.
Yeah.
What I'd like to do, Vul, is go back to right the beginning, where it all started, where you grew up, you know what I mean? So you tell us a little bit about that, my mate?
Well, I'd like to start by talking about my illness.
Oh, yeah. Yeah, we will do. Yeah.
You know, it's me feet, me legs, a non-existent pain.
Yeah.
I get tremors in my fingers, in my neck. That's why I've got a twitch.
Yeah.
You know, and I've been to see the neurologist and they're putting it down to the second COVID jab.
What the fuck?
Fucking trust me. So I'm waiting on the results now, see what happens, so, you know.
That's the rule second time.
Yeah, so if you see me twitching and stuff, it's because of that, you know what I mean?
So we'll put that in there, all right? so what would I like to do, my mate, now we've got that out of the way.
Yeah.
Say you've been a bouncer, led a mental life, you have a bouncer, drug dealer, enforcer, you know.
We'll go back to the beginning.
So go right back to the beginning, mate. Right where I started, where you from, where you grew up.
Right, I'm from Westview in Hartlepool. I was born in Westview, 1965. I've got an older brother, Charlie. Got a younger brother, Michael. My mum and dad, Maureen and Chick, lovely people. That's basically the basics of it.
Yeah, see, when I first found out I was doing this podcast with you, Vul, we went and met a cup of tea with you and your kid.
Yeah,
it was Charlie. He's an absolute diamond of a bloke. So
he's a good kid. He's my hero.
He is, isn't he? He is. He's an absolute diamond of a bloke. Nice fella. But when we were talking, you mentioned like your mum. You know, she was the Iron Lady in the family.
She was. I mean, my mum suffered a really bad mental illness.
Yeah.
I suppose then, it was around 50 years ago when it started, they didn't really know about it. So they were sort of like, they were giving her like mad electric shocks to her brain, and I'd go and visit her, me and our Charlie and our Michael, and she didn't even know where, you know, that kind of thing.
Wow.
But she, fucking hell, what a handful she was.
Yeah.
You know, I've got fucking blokes still say to me, fucking hell, your mother. I say, we come home from school, get off the bus, there's Maureen. Fucking yeah. Stay on the bus.
Yeah.
Get off the next stop. She yeah. was fucking brutal.
Was she?
Yeah. Odd nail boots. Fucking big try in Bonneville. Fucking piss pot helmet. Didn't give a flying fuck. Yeah. Filled every woman in the fucking street in who wet themselves. But she had a mental illness, I mean.
Yeah.
I grew up with violence. I watched my mum and dad, you know, she attacked my dad constantly. She, you know, she didn't know she was doing it.
Yeah.
She fucking stabbed him with a big knife right throughout the other side. Fuck. And my childhood was just with them rolling about the floor.
Yeah, yeah.
You know, and like, give me his job, bless him. He never once laid his hands on her, yeah, you know.
He just kept it.
All he did was kept all their control, and he was a big guy, my dad. He was a strong guy.
Yeah.
I mean, when I was a kid, my mate used to come round and say, get your dad to do that. And he'd give him a 6-inch nail and he'd just bend it into a horseshoe,
yeah,
you know.
Yeah.
He'd get out the big old thick years ago, the phone books.
Yeah.
He'd half them and quarter them. And my mates were all like, whoa, your dad's yeah. like Superman, yeah, you know.
Yeah. Right.
Yeah, but he was a gentleman, never once hurt her.
Yeah.
And they would say that at the end, my mum died 20 odd year ago.
Yes.
My dad 8 years ago, you know, he missed her, like,
yeah.
You know.
Bloody hell.
He missed her.
Yeah. Well, you yeah. see your dad, so see when we had that cup of tea, we sat and talked a little bit about your dad and your mum and stuff like that, and you know, he had a good relationship with your dad and he'd give you advice what you carried throughout your life.
That's
you know,
right, yeah. Yeah. About advice.
Yeah, respected you, about the respect.
Yeah, always respect people, you know.
Yeah.
He used to say to me, if you talk to people how you would be expected to be spoken to,
yeah.
basically. And that's where I've always been.
Yeah.
I've got no enemies. I've got no, you know, I've never, yeah. in the old time, I don't think I've had anybody,
yeah.
you know, want to fucking hurt me seriously. Because yeah. I'm everyone's friend. I always have been. That's yeah. the way I've been.
Yeah.
And I didn't go out to get a reputation.
It just happened.
You know, you get people go, I'll fucking go in, I'll do this and that. And, you know, try to build a reputation. Mine just evolved.
Yeah.
Just evolved, you know yeah. what I mean?
But we were on about this as well, because when your podcast got mentioned, I was at a Halloween party a little while ago, and someone had said, you're doing Vulture's podcast. I said, oh, yeah. In fact, it was my uncle who said it.
Right.
And he said, I remember Vulture from years ago, walking into the pub. He said, when he walked into booze, he sort of, everyone was in awe about you. He said, yeah. about your reputation yeah. sort of thing. But yeah, he said, well, like you say, we'll go back to your childhood and that.
Yeah.
Obviously, you followed your brother around, you know, your mum.
Oh, yeah.
Your mum
and my dad, our Charlie, bless him. He was three years older than me. So, I want to go with Charlie. you're not coming. My mum and my dad, take him. You're taking him, look after him. So, my pals at the time were our Charlie's pals. They were all 3 years older than me. I'd have been 7 years old.
Yeah.
8 years old. And they fucking tortured me, honestly, God, mate. You'd be fucking like, we used to go to youth centre down in Myers Avenue, and we'd be out the back of there, and they'd pick kids out bigger than me and say, right, fight him now. And I'd be like, I don't want to fight him. Fucking fight him now, or we'll batter you.
Yeah, so you had to go in.
So I had to get fucking taught in, you know, it was fucking hell, you know, all in.
Yeah.
Are they going to give us it? Yeah. We'd go to fucking swimming bats, and they'd hold my head under the water. And I'd take loads of water and I'd go fucking blow. And then they'd say, right, top board, go jump off it. I can't do that, fucking head under the water. Top board, I'll do it, you know what I mean? Only because them fuckers wouldn't. They're doing the 3 year old. So up I went.
Yeah.
I thought, fucking hell, they're going to torture me, fuck it. I was off. Hit the fucking water, got out and went, piece of piss, that straight back up. Fucking get in. And they were like, I said, no way, I was kidding his mate. Oh no, we're not going up there, see you packing fucking fannies, you know what I mean? They're torturing me. So it's no small wonder I fucking turned out the way I did.
Yeah.
Our Charlie and his fucking pals, you know what I mean? They're fucking torturing us.
Cheers, Charlie, yeah.
Nipper Goffin and Sando and them, you know, the fucking good kids, don't get us wrong. Yeah. Proper nice people.
Yeah.
But when your kids, they're torturing me as a kid.
So what were you like at school then, Paul? How'd you find that?
I was a tearaway, mate. I was a twat.
Yeah.
You know, anyway, getting out of school, I'd get out. Like, it was me, Richie Wallace, Keith Wallace, you know, few others.
Yeah.
And what we'd do, we'd go in, get signed in, and then fucking straight down the field over the fence and into Keith's and Dickie's out, Richie's house.
Mm.
And we'd fucking play that all day. And then his mum would come in from work, fucking, I'm sick of this school, and blah, 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 blah. And she'd go on and then she'd go, yeah, lads, there's cream cakes. She knew we were there, she'd fucking buy us, because she was a lovely woman. She was a lovely woman.
Yeah.
But his dad, we were terrified of Keith and Richie's dad, like, is your dad, fuck off, no, I'm fucking frightened to get out the door, fucking hiding in the gardens and that, trampling people's fucking gardens and all the flowers and get the fuck out of it, Keith's here. We were terrified of it, but it was fucking good times.
Yes.
It was good times. I mean, I was a tear away at school, I fucking, I don't know, I just, we got, I've told you the story, we got fucking, we got banned from going on any school trips, you know. And, because one of the lads decided in all his fucking wisdom to get on the fucking wrong boat of Ringo Land and start killing ducks with a fucking otter. I mean, it didn't go down well, you know what I mean?
Yeah.
So we were bad. We couldn't go anywhere. So me being me, I said, right, fuck it, we're going on strike.
Yeah.
They said, what do you mean we're going on strike? I said, we're going to go on that cricket pitch. There was about 30 of us. I said, we're going to go on that fucking cricket pitch and fuck them. We sit here, when they come out, we're telling them to fuck off, you know what I mean? So we get on the fucking cricket pitch and we're sitting, and the fucking headmaster come out and he got told to fuck off, you know, go and fuck off.
Yeah.
And we were sitting and fucking hell, it started raining. It was fucking freezing. And I was looking at people's heads, we were all skinheads now, proper skinheads.
Mm.
The fucking heads were blue, you know what I mean? It was like, what the fuck are we going to do here? So after a couple of fucking 3 hours, oh, vulture, now I said, look, well, right, we'll go in. Fuck it, we'll go in. So they lined us all up in this fucking, in the main hall.
Yeah.
And he's giving us our fucking pedigree. And he's going along each one of us, he's going, you're suspended. He got to me, he went, you will never step foot in this school again. You're suspended, you know, that kind of thing. I thought, fucking yes, that's me, I'm going to fucking get out of jail, fucking free card, I'm gone, you know what I mean? Wow. And I think that was me the last couple of years.
Yeah.
And I remember, I think it was our last day of school, and I thought, fucking, I'm going to school. So I went and sat in the class where I'm supposed to be, and, oh, who are you?
Mm.
I said, I'm Paul Pound. And I went, you know, I said, fucking, I don't like. And like, look at me, I said, well, he haven't been for a couple of years, so I thought I'd come today.
Yeah.
What, the last day? I said, yeah, the last fucking day, why not? Anyway, I lasted about 20 minutes to climb across the desk, the window just jumped out and fucked off, yeah. I thought, fuck this. I remember now why I didn't like it.
I've got to ask you this as well, Vulture. I should have asked this earlier, but I'll do it now. Is the name Vulture, it's like, I know you didn't get it from fucking eating dead animal carcasses
on the plains of Africa.
So where did it come from?
We were in fucking, I think, infant school or early junior school. And I was sat at the table with people. Somebody would take food off your plate, they'd go around bullies, but I fucking take. And then mum come round to my plate and he put his hand on my plate and I stuck the fucking fork straight in the back of his hand. And he fucking screamed. And somebody said, fucking hell, he's like that vulture on the black and white cartoon where it sits in the tree with a knife and fork. And then it was like, Vulture, Vulture, and it's fucking stuck ever since.
It's
stuck all the way through my life. That's all I've had is Vulture.
That's brilliant.
Yeah, no.
So what about, I know, say, when we spoke before, you mentioned you got yourself into boxing, a little bit of kickboxing. How did that come
about? Yeah. Well, I didn't know till the other day, the reason we got into boxing was my older brother was getting bullied at school.
Mm.
And I went, fucking, is that why we started boxing, kiddie? He said, yeah, that's why. He said, I was getting bullied, so my father thought, fuck this, get them to box them. And my dad worked in Steely Magnesite. He worked with Johnny Bowes.
Oh, yeah, the cook.
And then the other one, what do you call him? It's been that long. Morris Cullen.
Yeah, yeah.
Who fought for a title.
Yeah.
And stuff. Buchanan, he fought.
Oh, Ken Buchanan.
Ken Buchanan, yeah. So they were down somewhere near Church Street. I mean, I'll have been 6-7 year old. So I don't remember much of it. I can remember the ring, you know, you get like flashes and you remember the ring, and I remember the posters on the wall. I can remember Morris and Geordie. But I knew Geordie, you know, a lot long, up until he died, up until he passed, bless him. And, you know, but I can't remember. But old Charlie says he can remember the Feeney brothers walking into the gym for the first time.
John and George Feeney.
John and George Feeney. You know, look what they did.
Yeah.
Look what they all did. Fucking hell, how many boxers has come out of Harry Pole?
Well, it's to say it's always been a rich town for boxing.
It's got to be the richest town in the fucking country for boxers.
It's well known for it, yeah.
You know, I don't think there's many champion boxers have come out of one town in Harry Pole.
Yeah, for a small seaside town.
For a small seaside town.
Yeah.
You know, it's big on boxing.
Yeah.
You know, you Garside, Davy Garside, Michael Lunday. I just go on and on and on. You know what I mean?
Yeah.
You just go on and on. Yeah.
So you got John and George Feeney. You mentioned both. I think it was British Lonsdale champions.
Yeah, yeah. That's right.
At the same time, didn't they?
Yeah.
But, so the boxing anyway. How old were you when you got into that?
About 7 year old.
Yeah. How long did that go on for?
A few. Yeah. It went on a. Maybe 3 years, he had a couple of fights. I was fucking shit to be truthful.
Yeah.
And then he had a bit of time off, and then a one opened around in the school I used to go to.
Mm.
So we started there, and I trained there a few years. And then I suppose I found out that wasn't just for pissing out of.
Yeah.
You know what I mean? And you sort of like at 15 year old, 14, 15 year old, I was no longer interested. It was fucking beer was one and fanny.
That's it.
That every young lad, you know what
it
I mean?
It happens, doesn't it? That's when you lose most of them, isn't it?
That's right.
So I know, like you say, you got into boxing, but your passion, say we spoke, was the kickboxing, really.
Yeah. I mean, at the time of, like, I'd have been 18, roughly 18, and my brother Charlie, my older brother, come to me, he said, "Kiddo, I found this fucking karate club." And I went, "Karate club?" Because it was unheard of, you know what I mean?
Mm.
He said, "I found this karate club." It's fucking sound like. And I said, "Karate club? What, like fucking Bruce Lee karate club?" He went, yeah, it's fucking mint.
Mm.
You need to come. I thought, well, I've done now for a fucking few years. I thought, I'm a bit overweight, you know what I mean? Fuck yeah, I could probably do with it, so I went along. And anyway, first lesson, with me having a boxing background, I sparred, and I done all right, like, I was fucking, you know?
Yeah.
And the instructor, John Dawson, who I trained with, fucking hell, 20-odd years.
Yeah.
You know, great guy, great instructor, he's been at it. Fucking hell, way before I even knew about him.
He's
been at it a very, very long time. You know, and he said, you know, I'd like you to come back, like, you know, I could do with people like you, you know, in the club.
Yeah.
Because the club's starting to, like, evolve. Martial arts evolved from karate, kung fu's and stuff. Then it was, like, kickboxing. And then over the years, it was Thai boxing. And then all of a sudden, fucking MMA blew the fucking... The game right out the water, you know what I mean? So it was evolving. So I've done karate, I've done kickboxing, I've done Thai boxing, I've done MMA, you know what I mean?
Yeah.
So, you know, so I've been through all the...
So they say that'll play a part major on later on in your life as well, all this training you've had, like the boxing, the karate, the kickboxing.
Me and our Charlie, no word of a lie, every morning, 7 days a week, up the fucking beach... roughly 10-mile run every morning.
Yeah.
I'd go home, something to eat, and I'd fucking run to the gym, and I'd be in the gym 8 hours a day.
Yeah.
Every fucking day, 7 days a week.
Yeah.
And I was just fucking drilling.
Dedicated as well.
Yeah, just loved it.
Yeah.
Fought all over the country, you know, like karate tournaments and things like that. Mm. Fucking hell, I trained 5 years before I even took a grade.
How come what happened there?
I just wasn't interested in fucking having a black belt or any kind of belt.
You just like the training?
I loved the training. And by this time, I'd started working the doors. And I got in a couple of fucking, like, rough situations, and it pulled me out the shit.
Yeah.
It did pull me out the shit, especially my hands with the boxing.
Yeah.
So I thought, well... I've got two hands. Well, this, you've got 2 feet, 2 knees, 2 elbows. Mm. You know what I mean? You've got fucking, you've quadrupled your tools.
Yeah, exactly.
If you know what I mean.
Yeah. Advantage is yours straight away.
Of course, yeah. So yeah. I just, you know, I stuck with that. And I was entering tournaments as a white belt, which is what you start off with. And I was fucking beating black belts, you know what I mean? And everyone's scratching their heads. And John gave me his job, he was right. He said, Paul, you're going to have to take grades.
Mm.
So I said, right, I'll take the grade, next one, that's on. Anyway, the guy came up and you have to stand and do all your kicks and you know, all this kind of thing. And he fucking double graded me straight away and he couldn't work out. Oh, what the fuck's going on here, you know what I mean?
I was this white belt doing
I was the boy doing this.
Mm.
For his first belt.
Yeah.
And John had said he's never been in, he's been doing for 5 years.
Yeah.
So anyway, I got that and just, I don't know, just progressed.
Yeah.
But I was fucking reluctant to take grades. It just wasn't me, if you know what I mean.
Yeah.
I was more interested in, like, the fighting side of it, learning how to fucking to fight, you know.
Yeah, well, aye.
So, I mean, when I worked the fucking doors and I was in the gym, it's fucking funny this, like. They'd show me something. Or we'd go to a seminar. Of like, you know, like you had Master Sken, Master Toddy, these are all the top Thai fighters, you know, and you had other people in the company. We'd go to these seminars and they would show you things and say like, hey, try this, you know, and I'd go back to the fucking gym and I'd drill it and drill it and drill it and drill it day in, day out, a certain technique. And then I'd go to work on a Friday night, Saturday night, Sunday night, and you're guaranteed I'd fucking be fighting 3-4 times a night, knocking people out cold, and that's what I did, you know what I mean?
Yeah, using them skills as well.
Using the skills, yeah. So I'd go back to the gym in the morning, I'd walk in and everyone's like, well, did it work? And I'd go, yeah, fucking jackpot, everyone's on the training that fucking technique. If I come in and went, no, they'd go, oh, fuck that, we'll find something else, you know. So basically, they were looking at me to go, does it work? Fucking yes, right, it works. Get it fucking drilled, you know what I mean?
So it didn't work, you'd go back to the gym and...
Yeah, and then I'd just keep at it.
Yeah,
and then I got showed elbows, because you bust your hands all the time. You know as a boxer.
Yeah.
In the street, you can be accurate with your punches, but the slightest movement of somebody's head, and you're hitting with them two last knuckles, and that fucking, the thing shield open, that pain, it's fucking unreal.
It's called a boxer's fracture as well.
Yeah, boxer's fracture, yeah, it's fucking horrible. It was horrible, and I was getting it all the time, you know what I mean? You were fucking bang, bang, you hit them on the side of the head or the forehead, and you think, fucking hell, you know?
Yeah.
So this guy, who was at a seminar, he said, no, he's elbows, and I'm like, fucking elbows. He went, yeah, I'll show you. And he started showing me on the elbows, and I thought, fucking hell, they're easy then, you know.
Mm.
And he explained to me how you close the distance up, and you're this close to somebody, and you can fucking throw elbows. Punches are awkward at that distance, but your elbows, they're short, they're like, and you get power with them. So you have two elbows. One's it's a bit like an hook.
Yeah.
And it comes round this way. It's called a razor elbow. That cuts. And then you get a Thai elbow, which goes straight on.
Mm.
And that's a knockout thing. You know what I mean? That's a knockout.
It's a hard bit and of kick, that as
the
well.
The thing is, you get somebody with a guard like this, and you fucking smash right through your elbow. You smash through the guard. It's the fucking lethal, like.
Oh,
so once I drilled that, and you can get them all fucking angles, you know what I mean? Doesn't matter, you know, you'll see a space, you'll get the elbow in there, you know what I mean?
Yeah.
Once I'd fucking mastered that, fucking hell, there was no going back for me, like.
So what we do, the dormant days, how did you get about that then? How did that happen?
I don't know, I was just fucking in bars knocking people out and stuff, cheeky fuckers, you know, like. Fucking. See, the thing was with me, there's two things about me. I can't argue, and I can't fucking arm wrestle. I was 12 stone ringing fucking wet.
Yeah.
And you'd get these big cunts that come in and go, I'll arm wrestle you. And I used to go, I'll fight you. Fucking concrete out there. And they were, oh, what's that for? Then, well, that's where it's going to fucking end up. That's exactly where it's going to end up. So let's cut the fucking shit and get outside. No, it's all right. fucking am. And the other thing, like I say, I can't fucking argue.
Yeah, yeah.
I can't argue. I've never been able to argue.
Yeah.
So for me to say something to somebody and them to be the slightest bit cheeky and not clean out straight out, didn't fucking bother me. And I suppose when I thought about it years later, I grew up around violence with my mum and dad.
Yeah.
And in my early teenage, you know, there was a gang of us, the Bruce Army.
Oh, yeah, you registered.
Yeah. So violence for me was nothing.
Mm. So we'll go back to that that little gang, you call it the Postcode Wars.
Yeah, it was a Postcode Wars.
How old were you then, Vol?
About 15, 16. It lasted a few years, you know what I mean? 14, 13, 14, 15, that kind of thing.
Yeah.
But some of the lads were like 17, 18, you know.
Yeah.
And it was Postcode Wars. I was from the Bruss, Westview. You had King Ozzy, Dyke House, out in Manor. And it was Postcode Wars. If you caught somebody from their fucking, in your turf, they got fucking smashed to bits. That's the way it was. But we had the biggest fucking army.
How many of us was
there? There was about 100 of us.
That's some squad, that.
Yeah, there was about 100 of us, and we'd fucking, honest to God, and we used to chant, "We're the Barmy Brusker, da 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 da." But the 100 of us had got to fucking Dyke House and march through the streets with big fucking sticks and that.
Did you ever get it on like proper gang war? Like,
oh, fuck, get tore in, fucking get it on. Well, yeah, with the Dyke House especially, because they were the nearest.
Yeah.
King Ozzy wasn't so bad, because when our school was in King Ozzy, so we knew a lot of the King Ozzy lads, you know what I mean? So, and I mean, one of my mates, Paul Wallace, he still talks about it now. His dad sent him down for a pack of tobacco they had on at the shops at King Ozzy. You'll have to go to the Bruss. He went, "Dad, I can't go to the Bruss." "You'll have to." I can't. He fucking tell you the story, honest. It's funny. And he said, "I fucking legged it and I ran across the road. I jumped over the fucking, get the backy, fucking road, up the fucking road. If I get caught here, I'll get fucking tortured, you know what I mean?" So it was like Postcode Wars.
Yeah.
The Bruss shops and the Bruss pub where I was, where we knocked about, I lived 15 houses down from the shops. And that's where we knocked about on the night. A fucking shitload of us. And the police had come trying to move us on. We just had to fuck off. Anyway, this night, one of them got out and I think he slapped one of the lads, so we all fucking, we battered the fucking pair of them, we bolted them all over.
The busies, yeah.
I was only 15, we just fucking proper tore into them and give them, you know what I mean? And fuck you, the fuck are yous, you know what I mean?
Yeah.
And after that, we thought, fuck it. We fucking torture them.
Yeah.
So when they came, we'd fucking run up at the embankment, on a railway embankment, and we're just fucking pelting the rocks. Fucking windscreens out, fucking you name it, fucking big dents in bonnets, and they're busy fucking getting bricked, and then we'd run down and scatter them along the fucking street.
It's hard for them to arrest 100 people as well, like.
I mean, one night they brought the van, and we're all fucking fighting the busies at this side of the shops, and they were pulling them out, locking them up one by one, so they had three or four lads in the van. I can't remember who it was, but one of the lads, he boxed clever and he thought, he jumped over the wall, went round the back of the shops, came right round behind, opened the fucking door, and let everyone out. Fucking get on! Jackpot. No rest that night, you know what I mean? Fucking great. But there was like, it was me, John Gardner, Marty Campbell, Garbo, he joined the army after school, he's fucking still in there.
Is he?
Yeah, Jeff Garbutt. The Holland brothers, John Holland, Paul Holland, Sean Holland, my good pal Eric Forcer Egghead, his brother Noncus, Neil. It was fucking hell. But it just went on and on and on.
Yeah.
But Marty Campbell, fucking beauty. I mean, he's dead now, bless his soul. Yeah. Cracking lad. We carry on with the busies one night, and somebody, he went up, I don't know whether it was him, fucking smashed the window and robbed the fucking busies uniform. There was a uniform on the back of the hat. So the next night I goes up the fucking shops, everyone's starting to meet up. Fucking Marty walks around the corner with a fucking busy uniform. He's the busies, and I'm like, fucking hell, it's Marty. So we're all sitting on the Bruss wall, and he's standing up and he's going, stopping cars right in front of us. Excuse me, I'd like to search your car. Oh yeah, no problem, we're getting okay, out. But what they didn't fucking realise was he was a punk rocker and he had bright green fucking hair sticking out his busy helmet. It was like, what the fuck? And we were just fucking falling over the wall laughing. And he must have had about 8 cars and every one of them
pulled over.
But yeah, and anyway, we fucks off. And the next day, the next night, fucking busies were everywhere. Oh, obviously, somebody impressing a police officer, you know, impersonating the police officer.
Bright green hair.
Get rid of the fucking uniform, you know, like, that's out the window now. Fuck that, it was fucking mint.
Do you still see some of them boys out with that?
Yeah. A lot of them are still in the area, some moved away. I've got them on Facebook, fuck, you know.
Yeah.
Yeah, good set of lads. I mean, fucking had some fun together, you know. Crazy stuff when we were kids, you know what I mean? It was like,
best time.
There was that many of us.
Yeah.
That was the thing. There was that fucking many of us, and there was like safety in numbers, if you know what I mean.
Yeah.
And we all had out each other's backs, we wouldn't leave each other, you know. It was fucking great.
Some squad that way, some squad.
Fucking great, man. We ruled the town, and there was fucking nobody could touch us.
15-year-old.
The 15-year-old, we fucking wear the Barney brush by Army, you know what I mean? Well, of course, me boxing, I would, you know, we fucking, all my pals went boxing and stuff, so
yeah.
We fucking, we could have a little scrap,
you
know.
You could all have a smoke, yeah, well, go as well. I think that's where maybe some of your reputation started, like bullshit, do you think? Maybe them days.
Yeah, I suppose it did. I mean, yeah, I suppose it did.
Yeah.
You know, I had a few fucking fights as a young in the street and stuff and done all right, you know, no fucking flash.
Yeah.
You know, but I wasn't shy of knocking the cunts out, like.
Yeah.
I think, like I said, I think growing up around violence, it didn't really bother me.
Yeah.
I mean, again, I mentioned Paul Wallace. He said, he was telling me not long back, he said, I remember being in Paradise Alley, which was in Hartlepool Centre. He said, I'm talking away to you, I was working on the door. He said, I'm talking away to you, you're talking away to me, and you're looking over my shoulder, then you're talking away. You're looking over my shoulder, he said, and all of a sudden you went here, I won't be a minute. And I fucking walked across his head, next thing I know, fucking bang, 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 he knocked 3 fucking gadgets out. He said, the doorman come, I just, get them fuckers out. So I went back to Paul and went, what were you saying, mate? And he went, you just knocked 3 gadgets out, I went, don't worry about them, what you saying.
Yeah.
And we carried on the conversation.
So it was just
and I was like a light bulb.
Yeah.
I could switch off, switch on, switch off, switch on. It was fucking weird.
Yeah. Especially with all the training I see. Like,
yeah.
It's just the norm, you know.
I learned to control my adrenaline.
Mm.
And you see people before a fight are shaking. And
yeah.
I didn't care how many there was.
Yeah.
I went outside with about 5-6 gadgets, mate.
Yeah.
Not a fucking problem, one at a time. But do me a favour, save the toughest one for last. Simple.
Yeah. You always were saying when we were talking, Vulture, before you said you were good at reading people. You
know, fucking brilliant.
You could tell whether they were going
to... But I could tell where someone stood, what they were going to do next.
Yeah.
Whether they were going to throw a right hand, whether they were going to throw a back leg roundhouse kick.
Yeah.
But, you know, if you were square on, he's not a fighter.
Yeah.
You know what I mean? I could tell by the eyes and all.
If they were going
to
go...
No, we're not. When I was face to face and I was telling somebody... You know, I want you out.
Yeah.
I could tell by the eyes what we're going to do next.
Yeah.
Either like come back, go forward, go down. I could tell.
Yeah.
By what the attitude was, what they were going
just
to say.
Just the body language.
Just the body language, and if they went, I'd knock them out. Simple. Big elbow, bang. Good night.
So say back on your days on the doors, and that. I mean, you met it with some good boys and that, good lads.
Some cracking lads,
lifetime
friends. Some of them in the Bruce Army. Yeah. You know what I mean?
They followed suit with you, sort of.
Followed suit with me, followed me along, yeah. Stevie Ryan, fucking Keith Wallace, Richie Wallace, he was running the bars, a few bars and stuff. But there was others, came and worked, you know what I mean?
Yeah.
Got them on the doors, you know what I mean? They're tough kids.
Yeah.
Tough kids, why not? Get them on, you know what I mean? You want decent fucking lads who you can trust. And I've been trusting these since I was a kid.
Exactly, yeah.
You know what I mean? So for me, it's a no-brainer.
Yeah.
You know, you're not bringing strangers on board and having to find out if they're any good or not, you know what I mean?
Yeah.
You know the fucking worth, you know what they are.
I tell you what else we've spoke about as well, what we'll say to these, is Richie Orsi. He seems to get mentioned all the time on my podcast, but rightly so as well.
Listen, he's a top bloke. Fucking. I'll tell you what.
Could you tell a story? Because we've spoken before about is how you met him.
How I met him was,
go on.
I was in the people centre training and I was sparring at the time. And the door open and in walks Richie. I'd never seen him before in my life, you know, I'd never. And old Charlie went, "Oh, this is Richie, kiddie." I said, "All right, mate, shut, stop sparring that glove off, shut his hand. You know, how are you doing, all right?" Yeah, he said, "He's after a job." And I looked at him and I went, "I'm sorry, mate, there's none left." Mm. There was. I just didn't like the fucking look of him. He looked fucking mean. And I mean fucking mean.
Yeah.
And he went, "No problem, mate, thanks, you know, thanks." I say, "If his outcomes, I give you a shout, that's what you do, you know what I mean?"
Mm.
And as soon as the door shut, old kid went, "God, kiddie, you're making a mistake." I said, "What do you mean?" He went, "He's a fucking good hand, him, you know. He's a good hand." I went, "Strikes." He went, "Yeah." I said, "Right, not a problem." He opened the door and he was down the bottom of the stairs. I shouted, "Richie." He went, "What?" I said, 7 o'clock tonight, white shirt and dicky boy." He went, "Thanks, man." I said, "Not a problem, not a problem." Went in, met him on the night, worked with him. Fucking jackpot. What a fucking nice guy.
Yeah.
Honest to God, we had years and years and years together.
Yeah. So we mentioned your relationship again. I mean, you see, you went to
fucking hell, we become really, really fucking, like, really good friends. I mean, at one point, the partner he was with at the time, he'd split up with her, and he had nowhere to go. I said, "Come to mine." He lived in mine for about 7-8 weeks. Mm. I said, "I've got a box bedroom, you know, get yourself in there."
Mm.
And he went, "Thanks." I said, "Not a fucking problem. You get yourself sorted out."
Yeah,
yeah. You know, and that's what you do. You help people out, you know what I mean?
Yeah, well, aye. You must have some stories to tell on them doors as well. You used
to. Fuck yeah.
Because that's a force to be reckoned with.
I mean, I was on my own, fucking hell. I was knocking them out left, right, centre. Now, see, Richie wasn't. Mm. Richie was a fucking gentleman. Honest to God, pure gentleman. Everywhere he went, he would talk them out of fights. And Richie would never put his hands on anybody. He was he was like a gentleman, you know. And I thought, fucking hell, what a cracking gentleman he is.
Yeah.
He fucking looked menacing.
Yeah.
And I knew he could fight because he had a fucking excellent boxing background.
Yeah, yeah.
But he never ever fucking did it.
Yeah.
And I went to jail. I got 9 months for 2 assaults with a malicious wound. The malicious wound was a razor elbow. I cut the kid from his lip to his eye. And I'd said to her last on the morning, I'll see you at tea time. Because I thought, well, it'd be sorted, no witnesses will turn up, a fuck all, you know what I mean?
Mm.
Gets to the fucking courts. Already took us with, you know, Eddie Bryson, fucking gentleman, fucking honestly got tough as fuck. Mm. Proper nice guy, we'll speak about him a bit later.
Yeah.
Anyway, took me to the fucking courts. Fuck me, every witness and the fucking dog had turned up. So I spoke to Celeste, he went, "You're getting 3 years. I said, "Fucking get away and shite." He said, "You're getting 3 years. He went, "You have to plead guilty, mate." He said, "I've seen all the fucking..." He said, "Vulture, I've seen the fucking statements, you fucked." So I said, "Right, I'll go guilty." So I went in guilty and the judge said, I'll give you credit. We haven't had to go to trial or anything.
So he's just produced 10 credits.
Yeah. He gave me 9 months.
Mm-hmm.
So already had went back. And she said, "Where is he?" "He's in jail." She went, "Yeah, right." "No, he's in jail."
Oh, man.
She went, "You're fucking shitting me." She went, "No, we had 9 months, we were in 3 years, and all the witnesses turned up." See, me, I was offered. People said to me, "We'll sort this out, we'll stop the fucking witnesses, we'll fucking..." And I went, "Nah, it'll be all right, man, it'll be all right." That was my attitude, you know what I mean? Mm. Maybe I wouldn't have went, because I know they would have done the job, but fuck no, they would have stopped the witnesses coming. But me, I was, "Nah, I fucking don't worry about it, it'll be right." Well, fucking right, all right, 9 months.
Where did they send you, like, for?
Tell him.
What was that like? What was that like getting in there?
Well, that would have been fucking hell, 1985.
Yeah.
It was 1985, yeah, fucking, it was a shithole.
Yeah.
You're fucking shit and pissed in the bucket. There was 4 men in a 2-man cell on bunks. You had to fucking pass each other, like, you know, it was fucking shit. Yeah. 1 shower a week. So you'd get fucking dishes of water and you'd have to strip off in front of your pad mates and fucking wash yourself in a fucking dish, you know what I mean? It was fucking barbaric. Victorian jail, wasn't it?
Yeah.
You shit and pissed in a bucket. You tried not to shit in it, but whoever shit in it was there, they had to fucking empty it. If you shit in it, you empty it the next morning. So you'd have these big fucking slop out things.
Ah.
You poured it in the jail. Have you been in a public toilet that's really, really fucking bad? Well, that's what the old jail smelled like. That was constant. And I could smell it for weeks after when I got out. It was fucking weird, like. And I remember having to carry on with the kids. It wasn't, it was just a skirmish. and everyone got in between anyway. I got fucking nicked and they took me down the fucking block. And you've got the cardboard fucking bed, a cardboard table and a cardboard seat, and that's fucking it.
Mm.
So I fucking sitting, lights out, fucking turned all the lights out, fucking out the reading, out the fucking door, you know what I mean? So I get in the fucking bed, and all he had was this, he had these fucking knitted blankets, and the fucking no good to no cunt jail, mate, honest to God. It was middle of fucking November, December, there was no fucking window. There was a window, but there was no glass in the basket. Oh. No, no plastic.
Mm.
The fucking wind was out as in, I was fucking shivering. And I'm laying and I thought, I can hear fucking, what's that? And when I look up and the moonlight coming through, I thought, the walls are moving.
Mm.
So I fucking got up and I went, crunch, crunch. I thought, what the fuck's that? When I looked, fucking cockroaches everywhere.
Oh, no.
They were fucking everywhere. I pressed the fucking button, the screw switch the light on. I looked and they were just scurrying, pulling out the window. I went, get me the fuck out of here. He went, switch the light off the cunt, walked away.
Get back to bed.
So I fucking got in bed. I took my socks off and I fucking tied round my mouth, round my ears, so they couldn't get in. Honestly, fucking God, what a night. I fucking laid there. I woke up and looked and I thought, oh, fucking Jack Butler's not here. When I pulled the covers back, they were all under me fucking leg and up under me arms where they'd been getting the wall off me. Get the fuck it, I fucking hate them. I hate them even more now, cockroaches. Fucking horrible, mate.
It's like going back in time in that Durham prison.
Yeah, it was fucking barbaric, man. I mean, you'd be sitting in your fucking cell, you know, and you hadn't been out for 3 fucking days. All you'd been to the cemetery to get your food. And you'd be, a bit of exercise. And then the screw would shout, no exercise, there's rain coming. There's fucking not a cloud in the sky, the fucking wankers.
Oh, they just wouldn't let you out?
Yeah, a little cloud in the sky, nah, fucking no exercise. So you'd spend fucking day after day after day. And then in the summer, it was even worse, because you got 4 men in a fucking 2-man cell.
Yeah.
And their fucking sweat would drip off you. And it was stinking because you had no fucking, one shower a week.
Rough that way.
It was barbaric, yeah. So, I mean, it's all changed now. I went back in 98 and fucking hell, you got a toilet in your cell. I'm like, a fucking toilet in a cell? What the fuck's this all about? Mm. And then later, they opened the door and went, here, they give me a telly. I hadn't seen a telly for a couple of years.
Yeah.
And I'm like, switching it on, switching it on, switching it off, switching it on, switching it off, switching it on. Fucking hell, I've got a telly.
Yeah.
It was fucking mint.
Yeah.
All we had was radio, little radio, you know. fucking jackpot. Fucking swear to God, I am at EastEnders, Coronation Street. I've never looked at them fucking since. Never looked at them since, but when you're in jail,
yes.
Fucking EastEnders, fucking Coronation Street, fucking mint. You get right into the storyline, you know what I mean?
Like a big thing. Yeah,
fucking hell. The lads were, shut up, fucking Coronation Street, so I'm going to go shouting, fucking shut up. You know, fucking hell, man, I'm trying to watch EastEnders, you know, that kind of thing. Fucking great, man.
So how long did it take you to, you know, sort of establish yourself sort of thing in there? Or were you already a bit...
No, I mean, them days I was known in Hartlepool a lot, but not, you know, I was known in Sunderland and stuff.
Yeah.
Hartlepool, Middlesbrough. But Newcastle side, I hadn't quite got into then.
Yeah.
So, I knew a few kids in there. Anyway, fuck beauty this. They said to us, anybody, I said, well, I want to go to the gym. Can I go, oh yeah, put your name down to the gym. I thought, fucking great. There's the bags in there. Oh yeah, there's bags in there. Fucking great, that's me, you know what I mean? Mm. So, my first time at the fucking gym, I goes in, I fucking big old leather bag, you know, the big old leather things.
Yeah.
So I thought to myself, I'm fucking going to get on this. So I get on the corner and I thought, you fucking, and I start fucking smashing up with elbows, fucking smashing and kicking and fucking smashing it. And I fucking stopped, I turned on the old fucking gym staring at me. I said, all right, lads, went, oh yeah, yeah, just cracked on like that. When I looked, I went, fucking hell.
Everyone's watching you.
There was fucking big welts on the bag where my elbow had been,
yeah.
Where each of my elbows had hit. Big fucking, like, you know, the leather.
Yeah, yeah.
So I get back on it. In the end, I fucking split it, and the screws came, and the fucking was the last time I was at the fucking gym. I got barred out. The fucking round the back, you know what I mean?
Yeah, yeah.
Oh, well, fucking hell, that was me banged up again. I was fucking gutted. You know, you just need to get that fucking aggression out.
Yeah, just somewhere to channel it all.
Yeah, yeah, he's fucking, you know.
Yeah, 100%.
You know, it was good. It was, you know, to get into the fucking gym and get it out of my fucking system, but I only got to do it once. Yeah.
So was that like your first sort of spell in jail, that one bullshit?
Nah, I've done a fucking few bits and bobs. Done a few bits and bobs. Mm. Now, you know, not long. Mm. Not until later.
Yeah.
That's when the fucking bigger sentences are.
Yeah, we'll get into that in a bit.
Yeah.
So when you come out to say that prison sentence, what, did you get back on the doors after that, did you?
Oh, fucking straight back on them.
What was it like getting out then, all right?
Yeah, I mean, when you're only doing little sentences, you fit straight back in.
Yeah, yeah.
So you know, you fit straight back in, like, it's, you know, they had a party for me. I think it was 91. I went in 90, got out January 23rd, 1991.
Mm.
And they had a party for me in Paradise Alley, and I'd been training myself in jail. I got in with a kid who'd done the martial arts, so what we'd do, we'd fucking pull all the beds apart and we'd just stand and go kick for kick, you know, just fucking, you know, pissing about. And I was doing a fucking, you know, we were using chairs and putting your feet on the bed and exercising, using anything you could.
Yeah.
Lad made us. He got a fucking brush shank with two fucking plant pots and made us concrete fucking, you know what I mean?
Oh, yes, you do
all this, you know what I mean? Well, so I look quite, my brother said to me, fuck, that's the best I've seen you look.
Yeah, so you got a good nick then, eh?
Yeah, and me, little John Dawson at the bar. And he threw a kick and I threw a kick and that was us. And he went, fucking hell, you have been training, you know what I mean? Yeah, it was fucking good party.
Good.
Everyone was there.
Yeah.
Everyone was there.
So you're back on the doors now. You don't need to say a little sentence in jail and that. What I'm going to break into as well, Vulture, is we'll get into the debt collecting that, mate, you know, and you become an enforcer. But we're going to... How did you get amongst that game?
Well, can I tell a story?
Of course you can, yeah. Of course you can.
It's about Richie. Now, see Richie Horsley.
Mm-hmm.
I can no doubt say he's the hardest hitter I've ever fucking worked with.
Yeah.
When he hit somebody, he fucking had them. They went to hospital.
Yeah.
I could knock them out. He could fucking had them.
Yeah.
A left hook right to the body. It was a broken jaw. 2-3 broken ribs every fucking time.
Yeah.
You know. But before I went to jail, he was quiet.
Right.
Now, I remember just after New Year, and I got a visit, and in he walks, a couple of the lads, and he had two big fucking black eyes. And I went, what the fuck's happening? He always said, Roger, New Year. Yeah. I was fucking pissed. Two lads has fucking done us, like.
Yeah.
Yeah. Two lads has done us. I'm not going to mention the names because I don't want to, you know what I mean?
Yeah.
Anyway, I said, fucking hell, Richie. He said, I need to fucking do it, like, I need to do it. I said, well, look, I'm out on the 23rd. Leave it then, mate, and we'll do it. We'll get it sorted, you know what I mean?
Yeah.
He said, right, we'll wait. Anyway, I get out the 23rd. The 24th, he's fucking at me, you know what I mean? I'm fucking right, like.
Raring for it.
Yeah. So we went to the club where the guy drank and looked through the fucking carry-ons and there he was. So it was a matter of just waiting.
Mm.
So we waited an hour or so. We knew where his house was. We knew which way he would come down. So... next thing you know, the bar starts spewing out and down he walks with a couple of lads, and there was about 6 or 7 of us. And he squared straight up to Richie, he gave me his oldest kid, this big fucking heavy lad, a tough kid and all, by the way.
Yeah.
Put his fucking hands up with Richie, and my pals went out and said, whoa, leave these out of it, fuck all to do with them. I said, on your bike, lads, go on your way. Now to do with you.
Yeah.
We're just walking home with them, you know what I mean?
Mm.
Anyway, he fucking squared up to Richie. He didn't get one on Richie. Richie, bang, bang, fucking emptied him. And I mean emptied him. But he fucking went crazy. He kneeled down on his chest and he was fucking crack. But every time he hit him, his body moved an inch or so. So Richie was shuffling up, crack. And then he'd shuffle up, crack. He fucking moving the man. He was hitting him that hard. And it's the only time he's ever fucking done it. And I went, Richie, and he went, fucking get off me. Like, really? And yeah. I went, whoa, not with me, mate. We're pals.
Yeah.
And he went, I said, Richie, listen to me. You're not here to kill him. You need to get your own back, you know what I mean? You fucking need to get your own back, not kill him.
Mm. He's obviously been stewing on that for a long time.
Oh, fucking, it's been on his mind what he's going to do to him, what he's not going to do to him. And I said, Richie, enough, mate, enough, come on, enough. And he went, all right, I'm sorry, mate. I said, no, don't worry. And as we walked away, he turned around and he fucking ran back and he fucking volleyed him in the face, honest to God, mate. He was laid on his side and he fucking spun right round. That's how hard he kicked him. He spun him round. I went, fuck me, Rich. And when I went back, he was laid on his back and there was fucking gaggling blood. There was blood gaggling out of him. Mm. I said, Richie, get in the fucking motor, mate. Get in the motor door. And I went home and I got in bed. And I laid down and all this went, what's happened? I said, why? She went, your fucking full body's shaking, trembling. I thought he killed him.
Mm.
I thought, that kid's not going to make the night. He's not going to make the night, that lad.
Jeez, wow.
And then, for me, after that, Richie took no prisoners. There was no more Mr. Nice Guy.
Mm.
He'd had enough.
Yeah.
And that was him.
So he getting a gentleman wasn't really getting him.
No. Yeah. And that, for me, Rich, that happened to Richie and that changed him somehow.
Mm.
Mentally and physically fucking changed him. And he was fucking knocking people out left, right and centre.
Yeah.
Not bullying people, just wouldn't take the fucking shit.
Yeah.
I'm not taking no more shit no more, Mr. Nice Guy. He was fucking knocking out people 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, 10 a night.
Yeah.
Alongside me.
Yeah, there was a story that he...
And I'm like, what fucking hell, shall we have a competition? You know, get the fucking most.
Man, you wouldn't like to fucking piss about in that bar. You used to on the door, like.
Fucking... No, there was not many did. You yeah. got told, you know, that you knew there were trouble causes. So they would come and I'd pull them and I'd say, look, I'll tell you once and once only. We don't want no trouble in here. Because if you do cause trouble, you won't hear me speak again. You'll be carried out unconscious. Mm. I won't warn you again. And we understood and they'd go, yeah, fair enough. And they'd go in, you know. To wet themselves, got knocked out, they got fucking carried out, simple as that.
Yeah.
That was the way it was, you know, in them days. Early 90s, you know, we fucking broke them. And let me tell you, when the fucking ecstasy come on the scene, fucking hell, I thought we were going to be out of a job.
Everyone full of love.
Fucking love. I swear to God. Fucking, you'd have enemies, and you'd stand at each other in the bar, and then ecstasy come along. I love you. Fucking cutting each other. I said, that's fucking hell, we'll be out of a job at this rate. Fuck me, you know what I mean? The fucking envy comes fucking, I love you, honest mate. It's like, what the fuck, you know what I mean? It's fucking crazy.
You'll have to tell us this one as well, Wolf. When you search that person, the boozer. Yeah. I'll let you say a story because we've spoke, so I'll let you.
Right, what we used to do, right? We had a couple of kids in bars and stuff. And he'd walk around and watch for drug dealers selling ecstasy, cocaine, whatever, you know what I mean?
Yeah.
So he'd come and say, Vulture, I found one, he's selling coke, you know. And I'd say, go and fucking point him out. So he'd go in there. So we'd get them, take them out, take the drugs off him, and give them to the kid who was just fucking, you know, and he would sell them and give us the money.
Yeah.
He'd get a split, you know what I mean? So it was quite lucrative, if you know what I mean.
Yeah.
You know, free drugs and we were getting paid.
Yeah.
So this night, he comes with a Vulture, I found one. So where is he? He went, I said, go over and point him out. He went, I went, right, not a problem. He fucks off, I goes over. I said, can he come with me, mate? What for? I said, need to speak to him. All right. Opens the backfire doors. Shut the doors. So where's the drugs? What drugs? Bust the fucking lips and nose off him. The fucking drugs. I said, take your pants down. Fucking pants down, your fucking pants down. Squat. And I'm fucking squatting. Nothing there. I don't sell drugs, mate. I don't sell. He's fucking banging on the door, this lad. I spun up. I said, fucking what? He went, you've got the wrong one, man. It was a fucking lad stood next to him. I went, oh, fucking God. I said, here, mate. He went, I don't fucking sell drugs, mate. He said, I'm a fucking football player. I play for Sunderland. I said, you're a professional football player. He said, yeah, I play for Sunderland. He said, I don't even, you know. I went, fucking hell, mate, look what happened. Pull your pants up.
Yeah.
Fucking zip, you know, sort yourself out. We got them in the fucking toilet. I cleaned them up, bought them a pint. And I said, look, any time you come to these bars and there's a fucking queue, which he always was queues.
Yeah.
Come straight to the front, that's for me. And I'm going to tell the lad to let you straight. And I was like, he went, "Phew, thanks, mate." Like, I'd done him a fucking favour. Yeah. I thought, fucking hell.
He'll have been over the road, like, get in front of the queue with his viewers and that.
The lads were going to me, fucking hell. I said, honestly, God, mate, fuck. You know, he'd fucking went like that, but it was, you know what I mean? He was like, it looked just him. What the fuck? I said, the young fucking, he went, "Oh, vulture man." He said, "We're banging on the doors." I said, "No, you're banging on the doors. It didn't go fucking far." I'm like, fucking hell, you're fucking a professional football player. It's not just your average fucking Joe.
Yeah, yeah.
If he didn't want to complain about that,
I could have been all over the fucking press.
Fucking hell, well, I was saying to him, you know, mate, I said, all we're trying to do here really is control the drugs. We don't want them in the clubs,
yeah,
the bars. We want rid of them. And he's going, "Oh, I agree, mate." Yeah. Well, fuck, we were taking them and getting them myself. You know, I couldn't tell him that, you know,
yeah,
what I mean?
Yeah, yeah. So, Vulture said, it seemed to come to the point when you've been threatened with yourself as well.
Oh, yeah, I've been threatened with myself. Yeah, oh, yeah. I was on Fifth Avenue door, early 90s, and the refused entry to this lad. He was a bit fucking pissed, you know. So, I'm coming out the fucking door, and I heard him say, "I'm going for Vulture." The lads looked at me, and I went, "Fucking going for Vulture," I said. He said, "Yeah, I'm going for Vulture." I said, "Where is he?" He said, "He's in Churchill's up the road." I said, "Go and get him, he's a fucking knobhead." "When he fucking finds out you've called him a knobhead, he'll fucking smash you to bits." And then I said, "Fucking go on, dickhead, go and get him." And I went on and on. I went, "Some couldn't educate him." And I went into the lads and went, "Are you fucking stupid? That is Vulture. That's not Vulture." He said, "It fucking is, man, it's Vulture." He went, "Oh, fucking hell." They said, "I suggest you fuck off home, mate." He said, "I'm going now." Off he went, you know, fucking beauty. Fucking beauty. Honest to fucking God. I was like, fucking hell, getting threatened with yourself.
That's a
lot. Put myself on my own knee and fucking spank me on ass, you know what I mean? It's like, fuck off. Fucking top it.
See, we'll go back as well, you know. Since when you first met Richie, like, yeah, you say, you sort of sent him on his way a little bit, you know, as you weren't sure, and they become good pals.
They become pals, yeah. Really good pals. Like I say, that situation he had over the New Year changed him. It didn't change him as a person. He was such a fucking gentleman still.
Mm.
But he was taking no more prisoners.
Yeah.
No fucking taking no prisoners. Where just before I went to jail, he was a gentleman. When I got out, he was a fucking beast.
Mm.
And then, like I said, when he fucking hit them, I was like, oh, you're thinking, fucking hell, you know what I mean? Fucking hardest hitter I've ever worked with. Like, I seen him slap someone on the back of the head and the guy's nose exploded.
Oh,
fucking blood everywhere. Fucking fucking hell. You're supposed to hit him on the nose to fucking make it bleed, not the back of the fucking head, you know what I mean?
He's a big lad as well, Richie.
He's a big kid, yeah.
Yeah.
Yeah, he's a big kid.
Same, like you say, he trained for years.
Oh, yeah, good fighter, great fighter. Fucking great boxer when he was younger and all. I've seen some of his fights,
yeah,
you know, on video. Fucking great boxer. Mm. Really rangy guy, like.
Yeah.
But he's like, fucking an awesome fucking fighter, yeah, like. He, you know, what they say about him is fucking true.
Yeah.
It's
yeah,
fucking gospel. Yeah. That man, fucking hell.
Yeah,
he can fight. Yeah. He can knock them out. Like,
yeah, he tell you what. When he found out we were doing your podcast, to be honest, Vulture, because Rich, you the mutual put his foot to you,
right,
sort of thing.
Right, yeah.
And he said, "Get Vulture on," and we all sat talking to Richie while listening on the phone, and he has so much respect for you. Like,
yeah, he does, same with him. I know he does. Yeah, he were talking just this morning on the phone, and he was wishing me luck with the podcast stuff.
Yeah.
Give me a few fucking tips, and you know.
Yeah, I know he's been looking forward to it. I can't wait for this day. He's like, oh,
yeah, he was saying to me this morning, he said, "Your fucking promo was mint." He said, "I just can't wait to fucking hear what you've got to say." You know.
Yeah. I tell you what, we'll do. I'll say that now while we mention these promos. Since I started this podcast, I was sort of by myself.
Yeah.
Anyway, Up at the lad lit.
Great kid, yeah.
He's come along and he's helped me with the camera and the editing, and he's absolutely took a load off my shoulders. He's been an absolute legend, so I give him a shout out to Lit.
Yeah, definitely. I mean, that promo, I mean, you sent me it.
Yeah.
And you said, oh, it's going to be tweet, we're going to do this, we're going to do that. Yeah. And I watched it again, and I watched it the third time, and I think I phoned you and said, fucking use it, that is mint.
Yeah.
That is just how it should be.
Really good. I was over the moon when he come on board, so he's an absolute legend. Yeah, fucking mine.
Imagine happy with it anyway.
Yeah, over the moon, mate. Over the moon. Good job.
I just thought I'd pop down here just in case there's any bother, you know what I mean? Be the doorman for the day, you know what I mean?
So we'll get back on here, my mate. We're back on the door. We're still on the dormant days. What I want to break into, Vulture, if it's all right, is you know, you've done a bit of everything, debt collecting and force, but we'll slowly break into the debt collecting side of things, my mate. Yeah. So how did that come about then, the debt collecting?
It was just my reputation. You know, I was fucking. My name was getting around, and somebody said, oh, I'm owed money off somebody. I know a guy, Vulture, he fucking get your money back, you know what I mean? It was that kind of thing. And I just get phone calls and knocks on the door, I'm owed this, I'm owed that, can you collect it in? Now, it's a fucking funny game, you know, debt collecting, because when I first got into it, you're fucking running about like a blue-ass fly looking for people. You get them and they haven't got a fucking pot to piss in.
Mm.
They haven't got a penny to fucking name. So how do you collect off somebody who hasn't got it?
Yeah.
It's fucking impossible. You can't get blood out of a stone, you know.
Yeah.
So I learned that pretty much quick. So my game was, has he got the money? If he's got the money or he's got fucking cars, whatever, we can take it that way, you know what I mean?
Yeah.
He'll pay back that way, like.
So you made sure that they were all right before you took the
job? Yeah, you had to, because you'd spend fucking days and days running around and the guys got fuck all. You weren't going to make a fucking penny. You've had fucking days and you think, fucking hell, you know what I mean?
Yeah. I'm glad you've come on to that part there, because we have spoke quite a lot on the phone since we mentioned this podcast.
Yeah.
There's also a side that you spoke, a story that you told me was showing a bit of your compassionate side. I'll get into that with you, Vulge.
Might as
well tell you your mind about the lass, you know.
Yeah, yeah.
You know, I'll let you go, you know.
I mean, she's from Hartlepool. I won't say what street or, you know, you know. Anyway, their lad old fucking... There was only fucking 500-600 quid. It was fuck all, really. But I think he was heavily into drugs. So I knocks on the fucking door, she answers the door. I said, "Is again?" She went, "He's left me." I said, "What do you mean he's left you?" She went, "Come in." And when I went in, the kids were crawling around the floor. There was no fucking telly, no DVD player. There was fucking nothing. He took every fucking single thing out of the house while she was out. So we were in the back kitchen, I opened the cupboards, there wasn't a fucking thing in the cupboards, the fridge was fucking bare. I said, "How are you feeding the fucking kids?" She went, "The next door neighbours have been making his meals." I said, "Fucking hell, love." She said, "Look, I can pay it." I said, "You're paying fuck all. You're paying now, love. You're paying fuck all. It's not your debt, it is." I said, "Look, don't worry about the debt. It'll be sorted, you know what I mean?" I was going to go back to the kid and say, "You're wasting your fucking time there, you know what I mean? You're not going to get that. He's done a fucking flit. He's probably sold all the fucking gear out the house, you know?
Yeah.
Even took a fucking over and everything, man." So I played on my mind a little bit. I got on the fucking motor and I played on my fucking mind. I thought, fucking hell, I've got kids that age. Fucking hell, what you going to do?
Mm.
I thought, oh, fuck it. So I just went straight into the fucking supermarket. I got a fucking trolley and I just started putting fucking crisps, fucking pop, fucking bananas, apples, fucking anything I could fucking see.
Yeah.
You know, and I thought nappies and the roughly, I knew what nap, I thought, right, there'll be that size of nappies, I could bought nappies, and I filled the fucking trolley. I think it was like 150 quid, I can something like that.
Yeah.
And I paid for it. Got the fucking bags, knocked on her fucking door. And she went, "What's that?" I said, "For you." And she started crying. I said, "What's the matter?" She went, "Thank you. What's your name?" I said, "Vulture." She went, "You Vulture?" I said, "Yeah." She went, "You're supposed to be really fucking nasty."
Yeah.
And I went, "Not all the time, love."
Yeah.
I said, "Well, in with the bags." Yeah. And I went in the back kitchen and put all the gear in the cupboards and there was loads of milk in the fridge and fucking yogurts and all that kind of thing.
Yeah.
I said, "You're going to need it for the kids. you know. She said, I'm putting a first claim and it's going to take a while, you know. Yeah. I said, not a fucking problem, you know. Filled it all up and she thanked me and, you know, waved goodbye anyway. I was talking to my fucking pal, I was telling him, he said, I've got to tell you there, I'm the fucking DVD player. I said, can I get him? And he said, yeah. So I got them fuckers the next day. I was over knocking on the door, you get these in your fucking house, the kids have got something to watch now, you know what I mean?
Yeah, absolutely not.
And she was like, fucking hell, Vulture. And I scrounged her over, you know what I mean?
For a car, honestly.
It's like...
Yeah, I respect you for that.
I never ever found them, you know, I didn't really look for them after that. But if I had, I would have had that cunt.
I would
have fucking proper put pay to that cunt.
Yeah.
I'd have smashed a fucking granny out of him.
Yeah.
I would have, honest mate, fucking horrible, low life fucking scum.
Yeah.
To do that to your missus and your fucking little kids.
Yeah.
It's fucking disgraceful.
Yeah, shocking.
Fucking disgraceful. And it's going on all the time. It's fucking happening everywhere, isn't it? You know what I mean?
Yeah.
It's like, I'm being in fucking houses down London, you know, to collect some money. And the fucking beer wet like that, fucking heavily pregnant, and she's got her fucking gear up, she's sticking fucking heroin in her vein, you know what I mean? It's like, what the fuck are you doing? What the fuck's going on in here?
Yeah, yeah.
You know, it goes on every fucking way, it's just... Yeah. I couldn't leave her, you know what I mean? I couldn't leave her.
That's why I totally respect you for that, man, fair play. But there's also a flip side to that coin as well with you, wouldn't
there?
You're fair, you respect, you say you bought that respect right through your life. But there's another side as well where...
Yeah, there is, yeah.
You know, we'll mention that. But there is a story about your debt collecting budge. I'm going to mention it because it's a cracker. You saw you got involved in with the Russian mafia a little bit down the line, didn't you?
Yeah. I mean, so, I'd forgot all about it, you know.
Yeah.
And I was... When the promo went out, a good friend of mine, Andy Fields, we've been friends for a lot of years. He's a good kid. You know, he's not a fighter gangster type guy. He's just, he fucking turned his hands to anything. He make roll cages for cars and that. He's fucking just, his two sons, Tom and Jake, 10-year-old, racing minis, that fucking strip them, clean them and rebuild them themselves without even asking Andy a question.
Yeah.
You know, he was so fucking clued up and he had them so right.
Yeah.
Fucking great kids, you know.
Yeah.
So, he reminded me. And he commented, Russian, remember the Russian? And I went, Russian, ? You're losing your fucking marbles. And I phoned him, I said, fucking, I've forgot more than what I can remember. He said, you must remember the Russian with the fucking black leather jacket on. And I went, fucking hell, I do. Did he have a pistol? He went, he fucking did, yeah, in his waistband. Well, the story is, I'll tell you what happened, was somebody was owed money, there was a few grand, and he'd asked for his money. This fucking Russian had went round with a pistol in his waist, fucking threatened him, allegedly in the fucking Russian mafia.
Mm.
So I said, well, I'll go and collect the money. He said, you can have the fucking money if you want it. I don't want him anywhere near me. He fucking scares the fucking shit out of me.
Yeah.
He said, I went home that day. He said, I shut everything, went home. He said, I was terrified. I said, where's he at? He said, he's in the unit on Brendan Road. Give me the name of the unit now. So I sent my pal away, me and Andy. So we goes in. Goes up the fucking stairs. He opens the door. There's a good six blokes sitting there. I said, which one's the Russian? He went, mate. I said, come here, mate. I need a word with you. As he got up, he fucking opened his thing there. There was a pistol sticking out of his fucking, you know.
Mm-hmm.
So when he got in striking distance, I went, fucking slap! Nearly took the fucking head off and wobbled his legs. I fucking grabbed him. I said, see, that fucking does not bother me, you fucking idiot. I said, get outside. He said, what for? I said, I'm going to fucking proper put pay to you, you fucking prick. He went, what's it about? I said, you know, I'm on £3,000. He went, I'll pay you now. Fucking squared the money up. I fucking walked out. I went, Russian mafia. I fucking shit you, you know what I mean?
Joking.
We fucking got outside, my pal went, fucking hell. I said, fuck him. You know what I mean? To get the fucking, to get the £3,000 with me pal, you know what I mean? We're fucking laughing, man.
Did you ever get any backlash off that?
No, I did. I wasn't asked. Fucking Russian mafia. You tell it, you know, they're moving into town, the Russian mafia. And I said, fuck them. Fucking Russian mafia. Fucking hell. The fucking next will be triad. Fucking hell.
Oh, God. Brilliant.
If they were moving in, they didn't.
Yeah. So,
So he was still on the debt collector, not my mate. I mean, you met up with some good pals as well through the debt collector, didn't you? Have some good mates.
Yeah. I mean, most of the people I worked with was the lads that I worked with on the doors.
Yeah.
Collected with us, you know what I mean? They'd come to me and say, I've got a fucking job.
Yeah.
So we're going to do it, you know what I mean? But, you know, and that's how it started getting around. And I still get phone calls now.
Yeah, I still get phone calls now. So you've even got guys, say some of the guys from you know, your early days, your gang, the postcode boys.
Yeah.
Did they come all the way through you from the bouncer days?
Yeah, some of them did. Yeah. Some of them went, obviously, their own ways. Yeah. But some of them did, yeah. Yeah, Stevie Ryan, for one. He was in the Candy Ranch, a band called the Candy Ranch. Him, Ken Maguire, Neil Force and Nongus, a couple of other lads, I can't remember the names, good kids.
All good lads.
Yeah, and, you know, they were a fucking fantastic band. We used to watch them fucking, you know, and I was in a pub called The Touchdown, and there was a guy called Mick Donnelly. He's well known, he's a saxophonist.
Yeah.
I'm glad I got that fucking right. Saxophonist.
You've been practicing that word, haven't
you? I haven't, no, just came out. And he's played with fucking Madonna, Michael Jackson. Yeah, he's from King Ozzy. King Ozzy originally. He's played with fucking, you name it, and he was touring with Lisa Stanfield.
Yeah.
When the COVID kicked in, you know, so everything slowed down for him. But no doubt he'd be getting back to it. But he had this bar.
Mm.
And I got the job on the door through Mick Sorby.
Because
it was my neck of the woods, see?
Mm.
My neck of the woods, it was easy for me to, like, you know.
Mm.
Anyway, he moved on a few years later and he opened a place in the town called The Ritz, which was live music. We had Bad Manners, fucking Sham 69,
yes.
All them. So it was either full of skinheads, full of fucking punk rockers, but we never got any fucking bother.
Yeah.
They were fucking right. They'd come to watch a live music and I'd fucking pogo and fucking, you know.
Yeah, yeah.
And it was a great place to work, you know. Yeah. And that's the place that was opening. Then I gave Richie the job.
Oh, is it?
Yeah, the same place was opening that night.
Yeah.
You know, and I knew I didn't have enough lads.
So you just got rid, so that's how you ended up with Richie.
Yeah, that's how we ended up with Richie through that, you know what I mean? And we worked together for years and years and years after, you know, fucking hell. And then when we stopped working the doors, we fucking collected together, we fucking, you know, whatever.
Yeah.
Whatever, to make a fucking few quid, you know what I mean?
That's mad enough, say, from you, from that gym, to saying you weren't sure about
him.
And you become lifelong friends.
He's fucking lifelong friends, and he's like, you know, he was on the phone this morning, and we're having a proper fucking laugh, you know what I mean? Like, if I don't speak to him for a year, when I speak to him, I say we spoke yesterday.
Yeah.
I like that, you know what I mean? Yeah. He's that guy, I'm the same.
Yeah.
You know what I mean? You know, if I don't see somebody for years, I'll pull him and I say, fucking hell, how you doing?
Yeah, yeah.
Nice to see you, you know, I'm like that, that's how it should be.
Yeah, exactly.
Because I see some people and they go, and you think, fuck, is that all about you? You
don't cunt. Years ago.
Yeah, I was fucking pals with you know.
Yeah, yeah.
What the fuck's that all about? That's just ignorance, isn't it? But yeah, fucking, you know, a lot of it came from working on the doors through to the debt collecting. But it was all linked.
Yeah.
It was all fucking linked, you know. We'd collect some big debts and all, some big old debts, you know.
Oh, dear. Bad situations you've been in with a debt collector and all like that, have they all sort of paid up?
They just fucking paid up, mate. It was like, I mean, some of them I knew what had to be done. I would go in with a bit of extreme violence to start it off, because you knew, or I was told, that there might be fucking, whether they'll pay or not, you know what I mean?
So you can hit them with the iron fist sort
of thing. Just go in full fucking pelt and fucking, you know, and tell them how it is, this is how it fucking is, you know what I mean?
Yeah, oh, man. I would like you knocking on my door like you're going to talk to them, right? But, yeah, you can have it.
I'm fucking 56 now, man. But I still get them.
You still get some mental,
isn't it? I still get them. And, you know, I don't think I'm having trouble with someone, so I pick the phone up and go, phone in. Pal of mine, no, not a problem, Butch, that's the end.
Yeah.
That's the end of it, you know what I mean? That's out of respect, you know what I mean? Yeah. Out of respect, like.
It's manner, like you say, his reputations of yourself, the same with Richie and Mick Sorby.
Yeah, I mean,
when you first meet you, when I was going to meet you, I was like, whoa, you know. When I have finally met you, I think, fuck me, were a fucking nice bunch of lads, like each one. It's mental, isn't it? It's
great. Well, like I said, my dad always said to me, treat everyone the same, mate.
Yeah.
You know, and don't think yourself any better.
Yeah.
And I never have. You know, I've sat in fucking, in, you know, I've been out with my wife, and we've sat in a crowd that people sitting next to us, and we're chatting away with them and whatnot. And I've went to the toilet, she's went to the bar or something, we've come back and sat down and they're all sitting there like.
Yeah.
And I'm like, straight on it. All right, like, yeah. Somebody's went, that's fucking bullshit, his wife, and they're like, fucking shit. And I'm like, what the fuck's wrong with people?
Mm.
What the fucking hell is that all about?
Yeah.
You know, my wife used to go to town with the mates and she'd come in crying and I'd say, what's the matter with you? Nobody will talk to me.
Yeah.
Nobody will talk to me. If I talk to a lad, I mean, she was never out to get fixed up, but if you know, you get in a crowd and you're talking to a lad, he ain't gonna fucking tap my vultures, message. He'd just walk away and not even fucking, she'd say, all right, he'd go, fuck that.
Yeah,
you know what I mean? It was horrible.
Yeah.
For my wife, it was fucking horrible, you know what I mean? Mm. But it was the way it was. I mean, I didn't know the extreme of what was happening.
Yeah.
Because I was in amongst it. I was on the inside looking out. You don't see a lot.
Mm.
It's when you're outside looking in that you see everything.
Yeah.
So it was a Saturday tea time and I hadn't picked my wages up on the Friday. So I was, Fifth Avenue was, when back in them days, a Saturday afternoon was fucking like, it was like a nightclub atmosphere.
Chocker.
Fucking bouncing to the rafters all day, all night, from fucking 2-3 o'clock right the way through on a Saturday. Everybody bailed in there, drink, fucking. We had Dorman on there and stuff. And she was heavily pregnant with Owen Nadine, my firstborn.
Yeah.
And I said, I need to go and pick my wages up. So I said, how are you? And she went, oh, no, Paul, you know. I said, come on, man. I said, how are you? We'll get a coffee or something at the bar, or you know, a Coke or something at the bar. All right, then, you know. So I get her hand to lead her in, and I opened the door, and it was fucking heaving. Now, to get from where I was to the bar would take you a few minutes.
Yeah.
After 15 seconds, I sort of walked through. Everybody looked at me and went. And I just walked through. Yeah. She said to me, when I got the bar, she went, what the fuck, what was that? I said, what was what? She went, who the fuck do you think you are, Moses? She said, the fucking parted. Just one straight line of people just fucking parted.
Yeah.
I said, did they?
Yeah.
I didn't even realise.
Didn't know.
And that's when it dawned, I thought, fucking hell am I? I'm having an impact on people.
Yeah.
I am having an impact on people. And she, when I got home, she went, fucking hell, that's wrong, mate. That's so fucking wrong, Paul. Mm. And I said, well, it probably is. I said, but I haven't.
You haven't went out to get that.
No, I haven't went out to do that.
Yeah.
You know, it's like nobody, everybody knows not to fucking mess with me.
Yeah.
Because if I catch him with the elbow, it's fucking hospital ago.
Yeah. Fucking. Well, this elbow thing, there was another one. We had a little talk with him, we went over a few things. But bear in mind, this is Vulture's first time. He's never really done anything like this.
I've never spoken.
So I never spoke. So, and he's come out, he's telling the story. But obviously, I had to do my research to get to know a bit about Vul. And we had a little bit of talk on the phone. And you mentioned this elbow because I love it. It was a story you told me. You were fighting and you hit a kid. I think you were
Church Street.
I think you were breaking up a fight. Or no, was it your cousin fighting or
something? My cousin, old Clint yeah. Bryson. Cracking kid, old Clint.
Yeah.
Good, really good family man, you know. And he's fucking, he's got a good build on him, you know. And it was a cotton club, I used to call it the Rotten Club.
Yeah.
It was fucking stinking.
I remember that place.
You know, everybody got in there, didn't they? So I remember coming out, and there was a fucking big, loads of lads fucking fighting. When I seen old Clint fighting, I thought, oh, straight across. And there was this big fucking Java taking swings at old Clint. So I jumped in front of Clint, he took a swing, and I fucking rammed the elbow in the room. And fucking bang, felled him. And I fucking at the others, and once everyone seen it was me, they started scattering, you know what I mean?
Yeah,
I thought,
yeah.
Oh, fuck that, you know what I mean? So I'm talking, oh, Clint, you're all right. I'm all right, Paul, I'm all right. Now Charlie went, yeah, hey, kid, have a look at this. I said, what? And I looked. I went, fuck that now. There was a hole in his mouth. It was like a black hole, all his lips were tucked in. And I went, Fucking hell, I took the and went and there was fucking a couple of teeth in my elbow.
Oh, it's made my legs so funny.
I fucking pulled the teeth out my elbow and I went, fuck me, I've seen nothing like that in my life. Our kid went, just one elbow. I said, yeah, just one elbow. Anyway, it turns out, I spoke to the lad years later. He's a fucking lovely kid and all, you know.
Yeah.
And he had to have fucking 3 operations over the years because I'd rammed all his teeth through his palate.
Fucking
hell. You know, I'd fucking, you know, 3 major operations to put everything fucking yeah. right. Like, and I apologised to him and he went, listen, mate, it's what happened.
Yeah.
I said, what do you hit me with? I said, my elbow. He said, are you sure it wasn't a paving stone? He said, because that's what it fucking felt like for days. He said, my head for days was fucking banging. You know, it's one of the
things. I told you another one as well. We'll go into this as well if you don't mind, my mate.
Yeah, I don't mind at all.
As we mentioned, your missus, you know, heavily pregnant, walking through the bar and that. But there's a great story, I think it's hilarious. I've got to put it on there. Is you got married, didn't you?
Yeah.
So was your wedding night, mate.
Fucking hell, mate.
I've got to say this.
Fucking, honest to God.
I'll let you go.
So we were a childhood sweetheart.
Yeah.
So we decided to get married years later. So I was at the Mayfair Centre. I was running the door at the Mayfair Centre at the time for Paul Hopper, a lovely guy, him and his wife. He's a dance, him and they were dancing champions, ballroom dancing and stuff. And he had the venue, and every Christmas for 6 or 8 weeks he'd have cabaret acts on and comedians. So I always got the job to do the door for him to make sure everything was all right. So I thought, it's a cracking venue, why not go there?
Yeah.
So we said, well, you can have it for now, you know.
Oh, yeah.
You know, just, you know, I'll make it nice for you. So fucking hell, it cost me £1,000 for the food. Yeah. You know what I mean? It was like Morella's pork pies and fucking, it was all, you know, proper yeah. stuff. So we had the wedding. We went back to the bus on the afternoon, which our Eddie Bryson and Beryl were running. And we had a good afternoon in there. And then me and Leslie went home. And a pal of mine, Tosh, he'd left a fucking bottle of champagne like that in me fucking front room. You know, with a nice card and that. So I said, the way is get this fucking cracked open. I said, fucking we'll crack. So we're having fucking champagne, strawberries. We get fucking showered and fucking shaved and she shaved us fucking legs or whatever she did, you know. We get fucking ready. We get in the taxi. We get to the Mayfair Centre about 7:30. So we goes in and everyone's shaking our hands and cuddling us. And oh, those who couldn't make the wedding on the afternoon yeah. were there on the night. So they were all up and, you know, it was fucking great. So I'm stood, I thought, fucking hell, I'm busting with a lag. I said to her, I won't be a minute, I'm going to the fucking toilet. So I went in the fucking toilet and I'm having a fucking piss. And I'm stood. And a pal of mine who worked on the cables with us, Rolly Bushnell, he had a cross on his forehead, Cross-Edovich, I'd call him. And Binbag the Sailor was another name for him, because when we went to work, he turned up with Bin Laden, has never had a fucking bag, you know what I mean? So I just called him Binbag the Sailor. But he was a fucking cracking lad. But he'd been out from the wedding all fucking day.
On the lash?
Yeah, where we went home and a couple of glasses of champagne, they'd stayed out.
Yeah.
On the lash, he was fucking blaked. So I'm having a fucking piss in him, walks Rolly, big kid like.
Yeah.
So he walks in, ah, fucking love you. Ah, love you, fucking blaked. I said, I love you too, pal. He said, no, I fucking really love you. Put his arm round me, fell back. Whoa, my foot went in the fucking trough, snap, broke my fucking ankle. I knew instantly, he gets up, he went, get up, mate, I went, you broke my ankle, pal. He went, ah, fucking be it. I said, you broke my ankle, mate, you fucking, he went, yeah, fucking. I said, get me up. He got me up and I put my foot and I fucking went straight down.
Oh.
I said, go and get old kid. So Charlie come in, I said, Charlie, it's broke. He went, oh, you've got to be fucking shitting me. I said, I'm not. What happened? I said, fucking Rolly Bush, he went. I said, no, Charlie, he's fucking drunk. I said, he's a pal, he's drunk, you know what I mean? Charlie was just angry, you know what I mean? Anyway, they had to get a fucking chair in for me, skip me on a chair and carry me out.
Yeah.
Put me in the fucking car. So me and my wife spent our wedding night from say 8 o'clock till about fucking half past one in the morning. Fucking in the hospital.
Oh, bad.
I was fucking drinking a bottle of fucking vodka and fucking, I was fucking chatting a fucking nurse off. She was fucking beautiful, Italian. My fucking wife's with us, you know what I mean?
Was she still on?
Yeah, well, my wife, she understands. We've always been like that.
Yeah.
You know, like, we'd be sitting in the fucking bar and the lass will walk in and I'd say, well, look at the size of her fucking tits on her. And it doesn't bother her. She's, you know, yeah. I never fucked about my life, you know what I mean? She knows that. Yeah. You know, we're like that, you know what I mean? Yeah. So we get out the fucking, the pot of me right up to me fucking knackers. Straight pot. Gives me a pair of crutches. We get to him. It was about fucking half one, quarter two in the morning. So I said, Leslie, somebody at the door. So she opens the fucking window. She went to chocolate with the bed. I said, what does you want? She said, he said, since you won't be doing now, can he? I said, fucking hell. I said, let him in. Anyway, let him in. He come up, took the bed in the bedroom, come in my bedroom. He went, oh, thanks, cos. Thanks, mate. How are you? I said, I'm fucking terrible. Like, I'm in the pain. He went, here, give me these tablets. I don't know what to wear. He said, get them in here before I come right. So I had a bottle of vodka. Fucking few minutes later, I'm fucking sitting looking at the telly and I looks at her and she puts the paper down. I pick the paper up started laughing. And I could hear him shagging her next door. And I'm going, hey, I'm so fucking gone, give her it, you know, like listen, my wife's going, fucking shut up, man. I'm fucking out my head. And I fucking laid on the bed with the crutch whacking me potters fucking out wrong with it. I was fucking
away with
it. And then she said you went. And you were out. That was you. And I fucking woke up the next morning and I rolled on and went, fucking hell, the pain. Honest to God. So there was a knock on the fucking door about an hour later. It was fucking Paul up with a load of fucking pies he took home, put them in the fucking fridge.
Off the spread.
Yeah, since you didn't get now.
Did they all have a good time at the beer?
Oh, fucking, they were all night, man. He had a fucking rib. A pack of twats. He had a fucking rib. Yeah, with a fucking. Hey, honestly, fucking God.
You couldn't write that, could you?
Well, while you were in hospital, the hospitality at the wedding was all right as well.
Oh, fuck yeah. So, I asked to see Rory yeah. Bush. Nobody's seen him. Well, where is he? He fucking went on the missing list 3 weeks to find him. He thought we were going to kill him.
Oh, my God.
You know, and he felt so bad in himself that he'd done that. But it was an accident. He didn't jump on me fucking back. And, you know, he just put his arm around me. He was drunk. He fell. He put me with him, you know what I mean? It was fucking an accident.
Yeah.
So I was saying, all the lads, tell him, fuck, it was an accident. Anyway, he come and see me. He said, Paul, he's fucking crying. You know, he's a lovely kid. I just want to apologise to you and Leslie. I said, no problem, mate. I said, how are you in? I said, fucking don't worry about it. I said, fucking hell, accidents happen.
Yeah.
He said, but not on your fucking wedding night. Of all the nights we made a fucking pull something fucking stupid. I said, it is what it is, mate.
Yeah.
Yeah, so my fucking wedding night was quite exciting. Like.
You had to get that in there, mate. I'm sorry.
Quite exciting. Yeah, fuck it. Hey. I'm mad in it. What happens to you? They go, fucking hell.
There was a few things we spoke about, different things that happened when we sat with your kid having a cuppa.
Yeah.
And I thought, fuck me, this would be a fucking brilliant film. It would. Absolutely fucking brilliant. So what I'll do, mate, we'll go back to with the story, you know, on the doors, Dick collecting, become the enforcer. What did that consist of, enforcing, like?
And well, all I'm basically doing was enforcing fucking drugs.
Yeah.
It's like, if somebody was selling, you know, and they were fucking, you know, you'd get a guy, he'd put a couple of people in houses selling fucking cocaine and, or ecstasy and cocaine mainly. What I would do is enforce it. So I would tell everybody, nobody touches them people.
Right.
Yeah. You know, and that's how you'd enforce it. So I would get a wage by making sure with them fucking...
Everything went smooth.
Nobody moved in. Nobody taxed them. Nobody fucking moved in on the plot and tried to take over or nobody sold drugs nearby, you know, that kind of thing.
Yeah, yeah.
So that's basically, that went on for years, that.
Yeah.
That went on for years.
You do all right money-wise on that, like?
Yeah, I mean, see me, I make £1,000 and I'll spend £1,000 a penny. So I was out of fucking pocket.
Yeah. More you got, the more you spend.
I'd buy fucking 7-8 cars. What the fuck do I want 7-8 cars? Fucking speedboat, fucking jet skis, I had fucking all sorts on the back.
Yeah.
And I'm like, I didn't even need them.
Just, yeah.
Yeah, you're just fucking buying for the buying sake. It was fucking stupid. Fucking big, massive gold chains, yeah, and fucking bracelets and rings and like,
yeah,
what the fuck?
See, like you say, with the drugs and the bits and bobs, I mean, you just thought you sort of breaking it now all the time slowly, but then you sort of hit it quite big time, didn't you, eventually?
I did, yeah. I met a few lads. I met a good pal of mine from Sunderland. I'm not going to mention his name. You know, and he was in with a firm down in London. And they were getting large amounts of whatever you wanted.
Mm.
So we started off pretty small. I think I told you, we were getting fucking kilos of fucking bars, 4 bars a kilo, a dope, in a fucking asparagus tin, all sealed with a label on.
Mm.
So I had about 7 of them in my fucking cupboard waiting for somebody to come for them, and the fucking dog came through, it was the police.
Mm.
And then they come and they're fucking searching everywhere, and they fucking got all these asparagus tins out. And he went, fucking hell, Vulture, a lot of asparagus. I said, I fucking love this stuff. I said, fucking, have you tried it before? I thought, fuck, you didn't ask for a tin. They said, no, it's a fucking hell, it's lovely, man. You know, fucking asparagus, fucking hell, I can't get enough of the stuff, like. All right, and you put it all back. I thought, fucking hell. But when you opened the tin, it was bubble wrapped with fucking 4 bars in the cunt. So it was like,
yeah.
So when everyone come for it, you know, have you got a kilo of that? I say, yeah, and I'd give the kids, okay, go and take that to Wembley. Just chuck them the tin, just throw it in your boat.
Yeah.
And if they pull you, I'll tap the shopping. I was supposed to left it in. They're never going to look at it.
Yeah.
You know, you're getting cans of Coke. And you open them, pour half the Coke out, cut the tin, and cut it, and the bottom half was full of cocaine.
Yeah, that's mental.
Batteries, PP9 batteries, square batteries. Smash them, put them full of coke in.
It's mad the lengths to go on that to get them in.
Yeah. Even, I mean, what the fuck's going on there? There were proper asparagus tins, proper labels, there were proper Coca-Cola tins.
Mm.
They weren't fucking, you know, somebody do. I'm not saying it's Coca-Cola, but somebody who works on them has got fucking access to do these things, you know.
It's clever, isn't it?
Oh, fucking a genius ways of getting things in there.
Yeah. There was a couple of other ones there. And if you want to, if you mention it, like when you were doing your bits and bobs, I used to get it up from London some other times. A couple of times.
Fucking, I used to think of ingenious ways.
Yeah, yeah.
I'd send somebody down.
Yeah.
In a fucking that 500 quid car. I'd say, get out, go down late afternoon. They'd get down there. So all you do is you park at this spot, get out the car, go and get a cup of tea. I'll phone you when you're ready. I say, right. So they get out the car anyway. In the meantime, somebody would pull up, put the gear in the boat. Fuck off, I'd get the call. All right, mate, yeah, sorted, yeah. Nice one. So I'd phone the kid and say, right, do me a favour, go out. Get under the car. I said, arrive and pull at that fucking exhaust and get it snapped. He went, what for? I won't get home. I said, you'll get home, believe me. So he snapped the thing. Is it snapped, yeah? Yeah, told him where the fucking car was. So the A had turned up by this time at 8 o'clock. Oh, we can't do nothing with that. No garage is open now. We'll have to put it on the back of the motor and take it all the way home.
Okay,
I was going to pull the A.
That's fucking brilliant.
But I'd be in the house looking out the window,
yeah,
and I'd see them lowering the fucking motor off. Then a car or a cord would pull up and they'd get it off and on the back and gone, and he was safe.
That's mad.
Yeah.
Anyway. That's what you say.
Loads of ingenious ways of fucking to moving stuff, you know what I mean?
Yeah, yeah.
But sometimes, blatantly, you know, I'd just get on the fucking train with it.
Yeah.
I'd get on the train with it and come home, blatantly. Because they're not expecting you to do that. They're not expecting, you know, fucking hell, it's 500 grand at the fucking gate in some cases. As far as they're concerned, he's been on holiday, they're not fucking, you know what I mean?
Yeah.
There was no sniffer dogs then, in airports and stuff, in airports or train stations.
Yeah.
There was no sniffer dogs, you know, because there was no terrorism then, really. It was only the IRA. You know, it was the IRA and that was it.
Mm.
So they had no need for them. So you could basically walk through them places unnoticed.
That's mad, isn't it? Yeah. That's absolutely mental.
Yeah.
So, Vulture, like you say, we've got amongst the drug game a bit.
Yeah.
You're starting to do really well. Money's pouring in.
Yeah.
What was your lifestyle like? What was that like?
Fucking crazy, man.
Was it?
Yeah. Yeah, it was champagne and strawberries.
Oh, man. Yeah.
It was like, we never lit the oven for fucking years. It was fucking, I'd go about my business, what I had to do on the daytime.
Mm.
I'd come home, we'd pick the kids up from school, and just pick a restaurant in the northeast.
Big wheel at that.
Fucking every night.
Yeah.
We just fucking had our tomahawk steaks or fucking lobsters on top, and you know what I mean?
Yeah.
It was like fucking, and like I'd say, it was. I think now they're thinking, fucking hell, nice bottle of champagne, she's driving, fucking 70, 80 quid for a bottle of champagne while I'm having my tea. You know,
not even bothered at all, yeah.
That fucking money doesn't matter, it was coming out my fucking ears at the time, mate.
Yeah.
Coming out my ears.
That's mad.
Yeah. You know. But that's what we did.
Yeah.
You know, fucking hell. I know, we got sick of that. And we started ordering from the fucking local kebab shop and that, pizzas and that for the kids, you know. And fucking hell, I spent that much money with them. They come round at Christmas with fucking, like fucking Christmas presents for the kids and that. The local kebab shop, selection boxes, and little presents for the kids for Christmas. Fucking hell, man, they would have had thousands and thousands out of us. You know what I mean? Thanks very much, lads. You know, great. Oh, fucking hell.
Yeah.
You'd spend some money. I mean, my local angling shop, you know, I like my fishing at the time. I used to go up to Loch Ken, Loch Hall, then. I also like me sea fishing. I used to take my son, Connor, when he was a young one. And I'd fucking go in there, and if there was new rods out, I wanted three. If there was new reels out, I wanted three.
Yeah.
And I'd spend an absolute fucking fortune.
Oh,
you know, I'd spend that much money. In the end, if our Connor went in on his own for some stuff, he'd get a basket. He'd fill the fucking basket with gear. They'd put it in the bag and so, I'll see your dad about that, son. Because I was spending that much fucking money in there. So when I was in the jail, I said, oh, lads, get me the angling shop's number. I'll give them a ring, see how they're doing. So I phoned them. And they were like, fucking hell, Vulture, when are you getting out? I said, why? They said, the fucking till's down, mate. The fucking till's down. Well, fucking hell. We didn't realise how much you were putting in the shop. We fucking... £2,000 a week some weeks. I was buying all the best of fucking thermal
all
gear.
Of rotation,
yeah. All the fucking gear, you know, I was fucking, you know, and the same with the pub.
Yeah.
I mean, the fucking King Osley pub where I was drinking at the time, it was fucking Friday, Saturday, Sunday night, was fucking absolutely bouncing. And I mean bouncing. Every cunt in.
Mm-hmm.
You know, all fucking snorting cocaine, drinking, taking ecstasy, having a laugh, music blasting, you know.
Yeah.
And fucking the end of the night, when everyone fucked off, we'd polish the fucking bar down and I'd get a fucking big bag of cocaine, put it on, and I'd get somebody to fucking, it was like a keg bar, and they'd start there and they'd just fucking make one big fucking line right down the bar. And they had a solid gold hoover.
Yeah.
And you just... through the hoover. It's got fucking beauty, you know what I mean? So I put the hoover on the bar and just said, everyone help you fucking sell when you want it, you know what I mean?
Mate.
And I put 500 quid behind the bar, tell me when that's gone.
Wow.
You know, for the lads and the lasses, you know what I mean? And we just fucking have a rip.
Yeah.
So really, I was spending fucking £2,000 a night.
That is mad.
You know what I mean? Fucking, your average fucking day was £1,000. You know?
Man.
And I like me fucking Fred Perry shirts, so don't you know, I was going in, fuck, I had one of them, two of them, three of them, you know what I mean?
Yeah.
I was just fucking hell, it was crazy.
You like the jewellery and that as well, didn't you?
Oh, lovely fucking big old bracelets, fucking, and a fucking beautiful stars and bars chain I bought off me pal, it was fucking lovely. And our lass and the kids bought me a fucking solid gold shotgun.
Yeah.
And when he cocked it and he pulled the fucking cartridges out, they were solid gold.
Wow.
You know what I mean? And you'd fucking, you know, I had that.
Yeah.
You know, fucking hell, it was mad. But I fucking phoned the pub, getting back to the King Aussie. I fucking phoned the King Osgood and I said the same. Vulture, when are you getting out? I said, why? They went, no cunt's getting in. Yeah. There's no cunt coming in here now.
Yeah.
He said, it's fucking mad.
Mad.
It's fucking crazy, you know.
So how long did you get this going on for before you started getting a bit of police attention and that?
I don't know, fucking hell, it was going on a long time, but I was careful. I mean, yeah. I've never been caught with money or drugs.
Yeah, yeah.
You know, every time I got turned over, there was fucking nothing for them.
Yeah.
Not a fucking thing to be had. That's yeah. the way I liked it, you know.
Yeah,
what I mean?
Yeah, yeah.
You know, it had to be like that. Mm. I don't know, it was hard to tell.
Yeah.
But I know we're creatures of habit. When I walked in that pub, I had my own chair. Whoever was sitting in it got out of it because they know I sat there.
Mm.
So for me, and I've been told this off the police, they were coming in while the pub was choppy, having a drink. We didn't know they were undercover police, you know what I mean? Because it wasn't everybody you knew. You had strangers coming.
Yeah.
So they've been watching me, and they went, he fucking sits in that chair every time. So they came and bugged the table underneath. So I had three phones, two for business, one for personal. So I'm like this, constant fucking phone, yeah, drop off at so-and-so, do this, no, how much is it, fucking this price, you know what I mean?
Mm.
So I was fucking constantly at it. So they've recorded all that. Fucking...
So it's like a proper military operation, wasn't it?
Oh, yeah. I mean, the fucking... They got us to go. The lad who I was with, I'm not even going to mention his name.
Oh, yeah.
The lad who was with, he said, I've got a couple of guys here, one's from London, one's from Glasgow, and they want to fucking buy large amounts. Like, I said, so how long have you been dealing with them? He said, 18 months. I said, right. I said, get some of it on them, we'll have a meet. So we met at the Toby Carvery just on the outskirts of Hartlepool on the A19.
Yeah.
So we pulls up. It was three of us, me, this kid, and a guy who I can mention his name called Rudy X.
Right.
His second name was X. He was a black guy. Lovely fucking guy. He had nothing to do with my business, you know. So I was sat in the car.
Mm.
And bless his soul, he died. He was coming from Leeds back to Middlesbrough and he fell asleep at the wheel and died. He was a fucking cracking lad, honestly.
Sorry, you hear that, man.
Yeah, it was one of them things, innit, you know. Mm. You know, he must have partied a barad and had a lack of sleep or whatever, you know, and just fucking lost control and never made it, like. And also, I want to mention a kid that died last week, Jack Kennedy.
Yeah, go for it, my mate,
fucking
yeah.
Fucking really affected us.
I seen that on, we're from the same town, and so I get to see a lot of the stuff you see on Facebook.
Yeah, really affected us.
Yeah.
My son was fucking devastated, my daughter and that. Poor, I'm getting emotional myself there.
Yeah, mate. Okay, shout out to Kennedy's family of all things.
Yeah, Jack's family, yeah. I knew him when he was born.
Mm.
I taught him kickboxing for a couple of years.
Yeah.
You know, he was a fucking cracking kid, you know.
Yeah.
And from 10-year-old, that kid with his granddad, you'd see him loading the back of the pickup with him with different things.
Yeah.
And then he left school and he went on a couple of courses. And he never looked back. He was building walls, doing patios. The kid was never out of work, hard working kid. He had his own yard with his horses in and his trotting carts.
Yeah, yeah.
The kid was a pure grafter.
Nice.
And unfortunately, he had no seatbelt on. He's gone through the windscreen and he didn't make it, like.
Oh, I'm sorry to hear that.
Funeral's this week, you know, it's like, but I'd like to mention him because. He was a fucking lovely kid.
Yeah. Oh, that's lovely. Yeah. So from all of us here, we're all thinking of all Jack's family.
Thanks, pal.
So no regards to you as all.
Thanks,
mate. Yeah.
Yeah. So we'll go back to what I was on about.
Rudy X.
Rudy, yeah, fucking cracking kid, Rudy. You know. Anyway, he never got arrested because he had basically fuck all to do. When I got out to speak to people. I told him, you sit in the car, it's not to do with you. You know what I mean? Mm. You don't need to get involved, Rude.
Yeah.
He was fucking lovely. Anyway, fucking, we went to meet these guys at this Toby Carvery. And I got out the fucking van and walked across and there was this long wheelbase transit van. And fuck me, the back end of it was nearly touching the floor. I said to the lad, I can't be fucking driven. What the fucking hell? You can't drive that. So I looked in the front. It was clean as a whistle.
Yeah.
There wasn't a bit of paper, a bit of fucking anything. I thought, this is not right. So I banged on there. I said, you fucking dirty black bastards. Then the lad's going to me, you fucking paranoid, you. I said, I ain't paranoid, mate. That fucking van's, you can't drive that. And then I'm thinking, am I fucking paranoid? Have I fucking had too many drugs? And I thought, no. Like, fucking paranoia is in you, fucking, it's built in your DNA.
Yeah.
It's actually built in your DNA to be paranoid. Mm. And I think I said to you, have you never walked in somewhere and thought, something's going on here, and then something happens?
Yeah.
That's instinct, that's built in your DNA.
Yeah.
You know, it's actually built in you, in there. You know, you'll get 100 thousands of years ago, he'd have stepped into a forest and went, something not right here, I'm not going in there. You know what I mean?
Yeah. It's like, an instinct, isn't it?
It's an instinct that's built in your DNA.
Yeah.
So I'm thinking, have I had too fucking many drugs? Fucking. Anyway, I'd fucking, we walked across and seen the motor, they're in a disco, Discovery. Now, every time I went on a meet, I don't care who it was, I had a very, very good friend of mine. He used to get in his car and he used to get there first, get out the way, and he wouldn't leave till half an hour after I'd left. That was the deal.
Mm.
So we get in the fucking car, then two in the front, me and his kids in the back. So they're cracking away, and then one leans across and says to him, what's your name again? And I went, what's your name again? I said, how many times have you met these people? He went, oh, this will be about the third time. I went, you told me 18 months, you stupid cunt of busies. He went, the fucking not. I said, the fucking policeman, you stupid. I got out the car. The two busies got out now, fucking in his face, you horrible black cunt, you fucking nasty, horrible cunt. I'm no fucking policeman. I said, you fucking both stink, a fucking pig. You stink of fucking pig shit. Fucking tortured them. And I fucking stormed off. I said, get in the car. We got in the fucking car. We're going around the A19. My pal's sitting there. Phones me up and he goes, fucking 25, 30 fucking busies just got out of that fucking van.
The one you were banging on.
The ones I was banging on. About 25, 30 busies with all the fucking riot gear and that. They were expecting me to turn up or something. I'm a fucking daft, you know. I was turning up. Fuck all, like. Anyway, he said, he was on there's a little estate opposite.
Mm.
And he said, fucking hell, the busy cars that's coming out of here is fucking ridiculous. It's on top, mate.
The surveillance were right on
the surveillance is fucking on top, like. I thought, fucking, I said, you stupid fucking cunt. Well, I thought we could make a few quid. I said, we're already making a few fucking quid.
Mm.
What the fuck's human greed? That's what it is.
Yeah.
We make more. Don't work like that.
Yeah.
You know, and it's a lot of averages. What goes up must come down.
Yeah.
I've always said that you cannot be at that level and expect to last.
Yeah.
You know, it doesn't work like that.
Like say what goes up must come down.
Yeah, it's a lot of averages. Mm. You know. So anyway, I later found out that they rented the hotel as fucking five rooms right below where the Discovery was.
Yeah.
And they had all fucking cameras recording us and taking photographs and stuff. They said, we've got you step by step on photograph. Every step you took, we took a photo, you know. So it was a national crime squad and all.
See, it's a big operation.
Yeah, it was a national crime squad. It wasn't your fucking average Joes. I mean, they're hand-picked from different forces all over the country.
Mm.
You know, they're hand-picked. So they knew what they were doing. They fucking proper knew what they were doing. I think they were gutted that I was onto them. I got onto them straight away, you know what I mean? I should never have got in the Discovery. Like, I fucking knew there was something wrong with the van.
Mm.
But shit happens, you know, and I thought, what am I going to do here? I thought, I'm going on my tours. But I knew they were surveilling me. So I had about 10 grand laying about. I got that. And I said, well, I'm going on my tours. I got a little bag and put a few bits and bobs in. I give it to her to carry to the car, so it didn't look like I was fucking, you know what I mean? So we get in the car and I phoned me pal. I said, I'll tell you what I want you to do. I said, in the underground car park in Hartlepool Town Centre, I said, on the left-hand side. Do you know where I mean? He said, yeah. I said, on the fucking left-hand side there. I want you to wait there till you can get a parking space. I said, do me a favour and open your boot. Mm. I'm getting in it. It's the same kid who'd surveilled for me. He was surveilling the police.
Right,
they didn't know we would. I was fucking surveilling them.
Yeah.
You know what I mean? So, we fucking... I get in the motor and we're driving along to the fucking town and I'm looking in the fucking mirror and I could see the cunts behind us. And then I looked up and I seen the helicopter. I thought, the fucking, they're going to pounce any fucking time, you know what I mean? Yeah. So we pulls in and there were about four cars behind us. And you'll know yourselves, when you go into the underground, you know, as you go in and stop the car, nobody in them three cars can see what you're doing.
Yeah.
I went straight out the car, straight in his boat, shut the fucking boat. She drove down. I told her, just get out the car and walk into the town centre.
Mm-hmm.
She got out of the car, walked into the town centre, and when I spoke to her ladyship, Paul, it was fucking running out all over the place, looking on the cars, fucking...
Yeah.
He just reversed out and fucking...
Slowly drove up.
Yeah. We got a fucking few mile outside of Hartlepool. He pulled over in a little country lane, opened up, and I jumped in with him. I thanked him, you know what I mean? Fucking cheers, pal. He went, no problem. Where are you going to go? I said, Leeds. That's where he ended up. He ended up down Leeds and Manchester, fucking Liverpool.
Mm.
Then all of a sudden, my fucking money's running out. And I'm thinking, fucking hell.
Mm.
So he headed back north. And I said to the wife, I phoned the wife and said to her, Beavers, you know that little pub where we used to like to go? She knew what I meant, you know what I mean? I just meet us there, you know, pick us up. She said, I couldn't trust any cunt else, you know what I mean?
Yeah.
So she picked me up. She took me down to Westview, where I was from. I was on a few grand here and a few grand there. So I was collecting the fucking money. I got the fucking money together. I come out the fucking house. There's fucking red dots all over me. I'm like, oh, fuck, here we go. So I put them, I had a pair of shorts on and a fucking vest and a pair of flip-flops. Get on the fucking ground, get on the fucking ground. And I'm like, fuck, and I've got no head on the ground, you know what I mean? I said, for fuck's sake, I've got a pair of shorts and a vest. And what the fuck am I going to pull out a machine gun or somebody, you fucking tits? And I'd fucking get on the ground. I said, I'm not getting on no fucking ground anyway. There was two local busies there, police. And they said, look, we've had dealings with Vulture for fucking years. Whenever we went for him, we've never had a problem. We've never ever handcuffed him or anything. You know, we go and say, look, we need to speak to your Vulture. And he'd go, yeah, no problem, where we going?
Yeah.
Police station, yeah. Put my car, I'll jump in. There was never handcuffs, no need for it, you know what I mean?
Yeah.
So they said, he's fucking right, man, he's right. Anyway, they all put the fucking guns down, load the guns and whatnot. So there's these two National Crime Squad guys and these two local detectives. So I said to them, I said, look, I had a fucking big gold chain on, fucking bracelet rings. And I said, I've got a few quid in my pocket, you know. I said, I don't need these where I'm going. I said, can I give them to the missus? I went, oh yeah, no problem. And I thought to myself, fucking hell, I've got a debt list in my pocket. And on the debt list was every cunt award me money. That was proper jail. When you get caught with them, you're fucked.
Yeah.
You know what I mean? So he said, oh yes. So I took all my fucking jewellery. I've dropped it. She opened her handbag. I dropped it in. I put my hand in. I felt the debt list. And there was fucking about 3.5-4 grand there. And I just went, just dropped it in. She shut the bag. They thought it was only a few quid, you know what I mean?
Yeah.
That's right, let's go. Give her a kiss on the cheek. Let's go.
Straight in the car and off.
Fucking never seen Hartlepool fucking up 3 years up later.
Yeah.
You fucker.
Hell.
You fucker. I got out. When I got out, they gave me my vest, my fucking shorts, my flip flops. It was fucking winter.
To see, eventually, it all comes to an end in that full
show. Because it does, I mean, I tell them, the young ones and that now, I know loads of lads who's fucking at it.
Yeah.
And I say to them, you know, word of advice, get in and get out.
Yeah.
Because it won't last.
Yeah.
You will get caught. Mm. It's a law of fucking averages. I mean, I'm ashamed of what I did, really.
Yeah.
You know what I mean? It was just the people I was in with, my childhood, I just didn't give a fuck.
Mm.
I didn't give a flying fuck about anybody and who they were or what the fucking were, you know.
Yeah.
And I certainly wasn't bothered about dishing violence out. Yeah. It didn't bother me because of what I'd seen all my life, you know.
Fucking man.
It was fucking weird. Mm. And it's like, the money gets to you.
Human it becomes greed as well, doesn't it?
It's human greed. It's like fucking, you know, fucking hell, I've made enough in a day than what I'm fucking making a year.
Yeah.
If I had a job, you know what I mean?
It's mad.
It's fucking crazy. But like I say, me, if I had £1,000, I'd spend £1,000 a penny. So I was out of fucking pocket.
Yeah, yeah.
And I was in, you know, well, I've made now because I've spent a penny.
Yeah. say the downfall with the drugs, you know, you're being collared. Prison, court, prison.
Yeah.
Sent.
Yeah, one day it took me to Sunderland. They wouldn't see Hartlepool Police Station. They wouldn't take me anywhere near it. The National Crime Squad. They're not fucking daft. Yeah. They think he's got fucking busies on board. There's, you know.
Yeah.
This kind of fucking thing. So they didn't tell me where they were taking me. It was a matter of I got in the fucking back of the van. I was blacked out. They took me, and I thought, he's not changing gear, eh? Fucking hell, we're on the A19, where the fuck they taking me? I'm fucking sitting, and I'm fucking banging. Where the fuck are you taking us? Just ignoring us, you know what I mean?
Mm.
Anyway, fucking gets out the fucking van, looking around, I looked, fucking Sunderland Echo. I'm in Sunderland. There's a sign up there for the Sunderland Echo.
Yeah.
Like a billboard.
Type. Yeah, yeah.
So I fuck me, I'm in Sunderland. So I go slowly, had them talking, you know, and I was like, where's Kays? Is Ace Kays? How they talk up there, you know what I mean? And it's like, no respect, the young lads of the sun and the powers, you know what I mean? Well, that's what they like, isn't it? Where's Kays? Is Ace Kays? It's like,
that's the best Sunderland accent I've ever heard.
So I fucking got off track.
You're
so I'm in there,
yeah.
And they fucking processed me, put me through anyway. I think they had me about 3 days in there, and I fucking swear to God, I've been eating fucking finest food, drinking the fucking finest drink, you know, and fucking hell, did I not get the shit. The fucking shits and the spewing.
Yeah.
For me body fucking shaking.
Just flushing everything.
Yeah, no cocaine, no fucking fine foods, no alcohol. It was like, what the fuck is happening to me? They were constantly feeding me bog rolls. I spent hours and hours a day on the toilet.
Yeah, just getting everything out.
It was just coming out of me for fucking days.
Fucking baby, man.
And then they charged me, conspiracy to sell fucking cocaine, ecstasy, and they said, we've got you from Manchester to fucking Glasgow, which they didn't, because I had a phone number of a couple of kids in Manchester and a phone number of a guy in fucking Glasgow.
Yeah.
So they went, you've sold everywhere in between there.
Mm.
Fuck, but you can't say.
Yeah.
You know,
like you say, they never ever collared you with anything, did
no,
they?
No, they never got a drug. All they had was recordings.
Yeah.
They had recordings of me in the pub. They had recordings of me in the fucking Discovery. And that was about it. So I'm thinking, I'm all right here, you know, I'm pretty fucking, you know, so...
Yeah.
I get the solicitor, and he comes, he went, fucking bad, this like bullshit. And I went, what do you mean it's fucking bad? And he said, 14 years, are you like... I said, you reckon that fucking much? He said, yeah. I said, fuck off, you're sacked. So I'm on the phone, I said, get me another solicitor. I sacked that cunt.
Mm.
So I got me pal in Sunderland. I said, can you? He said, yeah, I'll get you one, yeah. I'll send you a fucking gun. He sent me a barrister. The barrister come in, he said, I've got to read through it all. Bullshit. He said, I've got a good look at it. You're fucked. I said, hey, I'm fucked. I said, they're all telling me this. He went, listen, mate, you're fucked. I said, no drugs, no. He went, doesn't matter. You conspired with others.
Yeah.
It's a conspiracy. They've got you. They've linked you with other people. They've linked, you know, they've got you recorded talking about kilos of drugs and how much they are.
Mm-hmm.
I said, well, look, what if I was in now, right, for, I think I said something like selling stolen helicopter parts. He said, you'd be here now charged with conspiracy to sell stolen helicopter parts. I went, fuck off, he went, that's the way the law is. They fucked, they've got you always. I said, what do you suggest? He went, go guilty. I said, look, I'm going to trust you because my fucking pal has sent you and I trust him. He went, honest to God, I'm not shitting you.
Plead guilty.
Plead guilty. Because they're going to fucking bust you wide open with a big sentence.
Fucking
hell. I said, you go in there and plead guilty. He said, and you'll get a fucking good third, if not more, of your sentence.
Yeah.
I went, right, so I spoke to the wife about it. And she said, do you, I said, Leslie, they're all telling me I haven't got a fucking cannel's chance of you. I'm fucked. I'm screwed. It's just a matter of how long I'm going for. Mm. Well, considering all my jail sentences has only been months and months, you know what I mean? Little, it was never like
fucking, little spells, yeah.
Yeah, little spells. I mean, I wasn't bothered. I knew what I'd done. I knew what I was doing. And I'm one of them. If I get caught, I suffer the fucking consequences. I'll do it.
Yeah, yeah.
I'll do it. I'll fucking do it, you know. I'll say I'll do it standing on my head. I wouldn't do it standing on my head. I certainly wouldn't like it, but I'd get on with the fucker and do it.
Yeah.
So I goes into court, pled guilty. Waits fucking couple of months, takes me back in. He said, I got fucking letters from Hartlepool, fucking United, fucking me pal Lee Pennick, you know. He helped me through with jobs and stuff, you know, Anyway, the fucking judge wasn't having any of any fucking thing. He said, you know, I wrote him a letter explaining, you know, fucking, you know, I'm sorry about what I've done. I know it was fucking...
And the way I'm budging.
It's just the fucking life I've lived, you know, from being a kid.
Yeah.
I've always been up the fucking summit, you know. And he actually took it into consideration.
Yeah,
he did. And he said, I'm going to give you the minimum I can. I'm going to give you 6 years.
Nice.
So I thought,
that's better than what you're fucking...
Well, so I went downstairs, they took me down, fucking get on this, they took me down, and the two guards went, fucking, I said, what's the matter? They went, walked along, there's a big glass things with the prisoners in, like separate. See this cunt here? He's just fucking been convicted of raping and buggering 2 10-year-old kids, a boy and a girl, and he only got 4 years. And they give you fucking 6 years for talking about drugs. I said, basically, yeah. They went, fucking disgrace.
That's unreal.
Can you open that door? They said, what for? I said, well, just to get a bit of aggression out on them. They went, fuck, we can't do that. Like,
yeah, there's 2 minutes with them.
Took fucking 30 seconds of the done.
Yeah, fucking, that's unreal. 30 seconds of
done, horrible cunt, yeah. He'd 4 years for, he'd rape and buggered 2 10-year-olds, boy and a girl.
And you got 6 years.
And I got 6 years. We're fucking talking about drugs.
That is unreal. That is mental.
Crazy. So that was the fucking story. I went downstairs. Our lass came down. She was fucking crying her eyes out. I said, I'm jumping about. Fucking yes. Fucking yes. And she's going, what the fuck are you doing? I said, I got 6 years. She went, Paul, you're gonna be away. I said, I didn't get 14.
Yeah.
I got 6. Yeah. I got fucking 6 years. Let's deal with it.
Mm.
And she went, yeah, you're right. I said, fuck, if I'd have went not guilty, went in there, that fucking pissed me. I could have got a 16.
Yeah.
You could have went for your openers, I'll get a fucking 18.
Yeah.
And I was in jail with lads who got them sentences.
Yeah.
You know what I mean?
You did the right thing, please.
So I did the right thing, yeah. I pled guilty, got the fucker out the way. Fucking.
Where'd you go to send you to Durham?
I went back to Durham, that. You know, at the time, it's a remand jail now.
Mm.
But at the time, it was a convicted place. When you go to court, they'll send you on your way. My old mum was poorly at the time.
Nice.
As she got older.
Yeah.
You know, she calmed down with the fucking violence. And so I asked to see the governor, and I said to the governor, you know, I said, my mum, I said, she's not well. I said, I'd like to go to Warm House. He said, we don't usually, you know, you'll be going up to Northumberland. I said, it's too far for her to go, like.
Yeah.
Anyway, he said, I'll consider it anyway. It was late one in the afternoon. The screws come and said, you're going to Home House.
Oh, nice.
So I thought, nice one, at least I can get, you know, I'm closer to Warm.
So, yeah.
I'm in with all the seaside lads who I know. Yeah. Because it was only me in the old fucking jail from Hartlepool.
Yeah. You know. So your Home House, I mean... How far is it from Hartlepool?
Not so far, fucking hell, 15, 20 minutes, fucking
yeah.
The max.
Yeah.
You know, I mean, Durham's not much further, but it's fucking awkward, you know, and Northumberland was fucking hell, 2 hours.
Yeah.
So I ended up in Home House for a while, And they finally shipped me up to fucking Northumberland to finish off. That was a fucking ache for them, for the missus and the kids.
Okay, I'm going to say this. I know, say we got into prison and that, you know, when you first went in there for your long stretch. But you mentioned this, so I'm going to say it. Your cellmate, when you first went in.
Oh,
can we say this, mate? Because I loved this one.
Oh, fucking hell, honest to God. I'd been in the fucking jail and now with the process, we took us through, they took me up, opened the fucking cell door, there was a lad sitting on the bed. All right, mate. Screw shut the door. I said, all right, mate, what's your name? I said, Paul. He said, nah, Kev. I said, all right, Kev, pleased to meet you. So I starts thinking in my bed. A few minutes later, all right, mate. All right, what's your name? I said, my name's Paul and your name's Kevin. He said, how do you know that? I thought, fucking hell, I can't be dealing with this cunt.
Yeah.
So I thought, all right, mate. I said, I'm Paul, you're Kev. I walked straight up, pressed the buzzer. The screw come, I said, get me out of this fucking cell now. He went, nah. I said, get me out of this cell. I was on the threes, like landings.
Yeah.
The ones, two, threes and fours. I said, get me out of this cell or I'll split my razor blade open. I'll cut his fucking throat and I'll fucking throw him over the threes. He went, give me 2 minutes. Once you make a threat,
they've got to get you.
They've got to take it out.
Yeah.
You know what I mean?
Yeah.
So when the fucking door opened, I threw all my gear in my sheet.
Off you went.
Say you later, Kev. Fucking hell. And I said, what I said to school on the way down, I said, let me tell you something. I am fucking really unsociable at the minute. Put me in with another knobhead and I'll break his jaw in front of you. How's that? He went, nah, you're getting a single cell now. Put me straight in a single cell on me own. I thought, that'll fucking do me.
Yeah.
Fucking hell. But that's the jail was full of them.
Was it?
Oh, fucking.
Oh, man.
The jail was fucking full of them. There was this kid, he looked like the fucking honey monster. He was fucking huge. Big jam jar glasses on. But he was fucking really mentally unstable.
Yeah.
And I remember him first coming on the wing in the association, and he came out with lads who were playing pool. He walked up and went, the pool, started playing pool on his own. He's fucking rammed the twist. So he attacked his pad mate, he attacked somebody in the showers. So they came to me, I was number one on the wing. So they said, Vulture. He's a fucking lovely screw, Lammy, they called him. He was in the martial arts.
Oh, so he was going well anyway.
Yeah, so I got in with the martial arts. I was in the martial arts magazine, the Martial Arts Illustrated, and I showed him, and he was fucking hell, you know, we're chatting away and stuff. And he was right. So he come and he went, they're fucking putting him on the cleaners. I went, you can't put him on the cleaners with us, like. He said, well, you take him in your pad. I went, nah, I'll kill him. I'll end up, I'll hurt him, I'll kill him, I'll hurt him or I'll kill him.
Yeah.
I said, fucking, hey, can I not put a stop to this? Like, there's nothing you can do about it. They need to keep him occupied, you can't lock him in a cell, he needs to be fucking mopping floors and stuff. So I said, there was nothing I can do about the crack on. So anyway, next morning, fucking takes a lad off the cleaners, poor cunt, you know what I mean? Good job, puts him in a fucking cell. By dinner time, all I could hear was fucking screaming. The kid had had a nap, woke up, he's fucking strangling him.
Fucking hell.
Fucking strangling the cunt. And he's screaming like a banshee and the fucking screws are in. They twisted this fucking big cunt up and took him down the block. Never seen him again. I said, fucking keep him away from me.
Yeah, he's obviously not ready for it now.
Fucking hell, I told you, man.
Mm.
Yeah, the fucking padmate went to sleep. He fucking tried to fucking kill him. Like a fucking big honey monster, but mentally unstable.
Oh,
you know what I mean? Was full of them. They shouldn't have been there.
You mentioned one before as well, when you're coming up for your rations.
Yeah, yeah. There was a big kid from Newcastle. Now, in jail, a lot of people won't know. In jail, you get rations, your portions of food are rationed. At the end, when you go out, there's two big boilers. You get a tea bag and sugar. And that's your cup of tea for the night. Now, this kid had just come in. Decides, nah, I don't want that, I'll just take a fucking load. So the last 20 odd kids coming through didn't have a cup of tea on the night.
He'd take their
rations. So I said, they were complaining to me, so I said to Scrub, I didn't say home. I said, somebody's taken the rations, the fucking last 20 odd lads coming through. You fucking sort it out, Vulture, you sort it out. I said, not for me to fucking sort out, it's for you to sort out. No, you fucking sort it out. Fair enough, so it's in this area, the lad came through, big cunt like. I said, all right, mate, yeah. I said, see you. I said, take any more fucking rations and I'm going to fucking empty you where you stand. How he understood, he went, yeah. And he went through and he took one of each. And I thought, job sorted. And he goes, bang up on the night. Next day, next morning it was, he's coming through with his tray. And as he gets to me, he goes, fucking, I thought, what the fuck, I turned. All the fucking sugar he'd been pinching, he put all in the fucking, this jug you get for hot water. And he'd fucking put all the sugar in there. When you put sugar in water, when you look, it's disappeared. It hasn't. What it does, it stays the same form, but it retains it like it heats up, but stays the same. Yeah. So when you throw it on someone, the water will go cold, but the sugar will stay red hot and burn through more layers of skin. It's fucking cruel.
Yeah.
So he fucking got me in the side of the face with it. So I fucking ripped my top off. I fucking tore into one. Fucking, I had a big pair of fucking ginger wet boots on, called them gingers. And I fucking proper give him it. And next thing I know, there's fucking two screws behind me. I thought, oh, here we fucking go. So I just went, fucking, you can have it. And all I went, no. I thought, no. I thought to man, he went, look at your shirt. I looked at my shirt, I thought, what the fuck's that? I said, what's that? He said, that's your skin. I said, me skin? He went, look down. When I looked down like that, all my fucking skin was gone. I could see all my white sinews in my skin. You know, in my muscle.
Fucking hell.
Fucking lot. And me fucking... I would. They went, come now, quick. I said, why? They went, the sugar's burning through. I said, what do? You need a cold shower. Fucking hell, they put me in a cold shower. It was worse than what he'd done to me. The fucking pain was unreal, yeah. But they said, we have to, Vulture, we have to cool the sugar down or it'll just carry on burning through the layers of your skin.
That's awful, that, mate.
So anyway, I made a right on mess of this cunt. So I fucking... It takes me to fucking... Jesus, a story, this cunt, man. It takes me to fucking Dryden Hospital. I think it's Dryden, near fucking... Is it Dryden? Near Durham?
Oh,
the hospital, I think it's Dryden.
Yeah.
Anyway, you feel a cunt going there because you're handcuffed to a fucking screw and little kids are going like that.
So they walk you from where everyone else is?
Yeah, it's fucking embarrassing, you know what I mean? So they fucking took us through and all the fucking, you know, me fucking by then, I had a blister. It was fucking gouge, covered my ear and everything. And I thought, I'm glad I fucking turned, because if he'd have got me square on the face, could have blinded me, could have fucking, you know, he meant business, like.
Yeah, yeah.
So they got me in anyway, they put all this fucking white cream on, and they wrapped me up in like a cellophane stuff. She said, this guy is new out, it really is good at healing. I said, what about scar? Will it scar? She went, no, your skin will grow back, you know. Yeah. Yeah. Oh, and all you can see when I've been in the sun is wrinkles. See little wrinkles, you know.
That's like, lucky, like, isn't
that
it?
Was fucking hell, it was 1998, you know what I mean?
Yeah.
So they sorted me out at the hospital. They didn't need me, so they sent me back to the prison. So we get back to prison. I said, where are we going? They went, the hospital wing. I went, I'm not going to no fucking hospital wing. I'd heard other stories about the fucking hospital wing, you know what I mean? So I said, no, I'm not good. They said, they have to, it's all fucking locked up now. They've let people on to let you into there, all that's fucking locked up now. I said, fucking hell. I said, one fucking night, and that's all you're getting out of me, I will fucking kick off. So they fucking took us through, said, stand here. So I fucking put me little bits and bobs what I had with us. And I heard somebody talk. I thought, what the fuck's that? In the prison hospitals, the fucking doors are this wide.
Right.
Where your normal doors in your normal prison like that. It's so, if you kick off, the screws can twist it up and one can walk either side of you.
Oh, right.
You know what I mean?
Yeah,
for the width. Yeah, so you're not struggling, you know. So I pulled the shutter open like that, and there was this fucking little skinny fella, looked like Cat Weasel. He had a long beard, a long scraggly hair, and I looked and there was shit all over the walls and everywhere. There was shit all over him. I said, "What's the matter, mate?" He went, "It's him, he won't let me on the bed." And I fucking looked, there was no cunt there. So I went, "Oh, yo, what the fucking bed, it's his turn." He went, "Thanks, mate. Go on the bed, the two screws behind me," went. "What the fuck was that?" I said, "Reverse psychology, man. We've been trying for 6 weeks to get him on bed."
That's fucking brilliant.
Fucking 30 seconds I had him on the bed, you know what
and
I mean?
And he's shitting everywhere.
He's shitting, wiping shit everywhere. I'm like, fucking hell. So they put me a couple of cells down. They said, "Look, Bulch, it's the best we've got. It's dirty, but you've got clean bedding. We've got you a clean mattress.
Yeah.
Just pull the bed away from the fucking walls.
Yeah.
Make your bed and go to sleep and we'll sort you out tomorrow." Fucking went in, there was shit all over the fucking place, you know what I mean? Just see the smear marks with the hands, you know, where they've been shitting and fucking just smearing it everywhere. So I pulled the fucking bed out to get a new mattress on, clean fucking bedding they give me. So I said, "Look, I've got a visit tomorrow." I said, "My wife's bringing my kids up." I said, "I don't want them seeing this."
Yeah.
Obviously, my fucking face by then was just a massive blister. I couldn't sleep. Even when I was 10, fucking, you know, rolling over in your sleep and stuff. So I said, "I need to fucking make a phone call." Like, he said, "I'll see what I can do. I won't be long." So he came back and he went, he opened the door. I had a phone card and that with us. They give us bits and bobs before I came out, you know what I mean?
Yeah.
So he said, "Go through the ward. Carry on all the way down, it's on the right-hand side at the bottom." So I said, "No problem." He said, "Come straight back." I said, not a problem. I have no problems with me. So I fucking go through, and as I go through, there's a load of white coat screws with white coats on, obviously medically trained. And I said, "I want me fucking medication. I want me medication. I want me medication. I want me medication. I want me medication." He was fucking... And as I walked along, I looked through. He had a fucking razor blade and he had his dick and he was slashing his fucking dick. "I want me medication, I want me medication." What the fuck? I went, "What the fuck?" The screw went, "Just walk on." I went, "I fucking am." And I fucking went down, I got on the phone, I was asked, I went, "You fucking never believe what I've just witnessed." And I told her, she went, "What?" I said, I'm in a fucking single cell where I'm safe.
Yeah.
I said, "Fucking hell. Don't bring the kids up." I told her, she went, "I said, I'm okay, just don't bring the fucking kids up tomorrow, they'll upset them, they'll cry, you know what I mean?"
Fucking, that's mental.
So she brought the kids up the next day, had the fucking visit. But in the meantime, on the morning, I said, "I want to see the governor, I ain't fucking staying here." "Oh, you?" I said, "No, listen, Dryden Hospital did not fucking need me. I don't see why you fucking do.
Yeah.
Get me back on normal location now, or I'll fucking proper kick off. I'll smash up, I'll fucking fight any screw that comes through this door, I'm not fucking asked. Get me the fucking governor." Anyway, the governor come and I went, fucking explained to him, I said, "I'm going to be on here." I said, "Fuck, slashing his fucking dick and fucking Cat Weasel and fucking, you know," I said, "Dryden Hospital didn't leave me, what the fuck did they need before you?" And I agree, getting back to normal location.
Yeah.
Fucking thank a fuck for that.
Fucking hell.
Like a fucking one who flew over the cuckoo's nest didn't have a fucking walking.
Sounds like Broadmoor or something.
Honest, it was like Broadmoor. But they were all criminally insane.
Yeah, it's must be frightening.
You know, fucking, it was about fucking 3 or 4 months later. I'm in my fucking pad, I'm all here by then, you know what I mean? I'm in my fucking pad and I've got the radio on and they come over the radio. Prison man stopped on fucking some road because the occupant of the prisoner was slashing his genitals. I went, "Fucking hell, that's him. He's having to get in the cunt. Well, how the fuck's he got a dick with the time that he was slashing him with a razor blade? Fucking hell, they came sewing him back on."
That's crazy, that.
I was fucking mad, mate, honest. The fucking blood. I'm like, what the fucking hell? I want me medication. I want, I thought, he's just ran the fucking twist. And when I looked through the screws and I stopped and his fucking dick, oh man, it went through me. It still does it now.
Yeah.
You think, oh, you cross your legs and all sorts, you know, like,
nip it.
Oh, fucking blood everywhere, mate. Oh, fucking hell, it was horrendous. It was like, what the fuck? Remind me never to go insane and go to prison. You're a fucker.
Yeah.
You could see them walking around in circles with dressing gowns on, just coshed out the fucking head, full of liquid cosh.
Yeah, I've heard all that, yeah.
Fucking just walking around in circles, mumbling to themselves. I'm like, what the fuck?
Yeah, you'd have to be off there, like...
Straight away, I said, the governor, fucking hell, will kick off, governor. Yeah.
You're not to turn you insane, isn't it?
Yeah.
Fucking scary. Fucking scary, but fucking... Apparently, I caused the kid some damage and all.
But the kid who done the fucking...
Yeah. His teeth good. Out, fucking jaw broke, well, this is what I was told. Never seen him again. Shipped him out. You know, fucking... Prison's a volatile fucking place. It doesn't take much... You know, everyone's head's done in, fucking, you know, they'll owe somebody on the wing back here, or fucking they owe somebody this, and fucking slashings all the time, a fucking beauty, right? Fucking. This kid, I'm getting out tomorrow, Vulture. I said, fucking good on you, kid. Good on you, keep your fucking nose clean, you know what I mean?
Yeah.
You know, so I shook his hand, was on the tight arm, I'm going to bang up, shook his hand, I said, fucking good on you. Keep yourself right. I said, you've no idea what I would give to get out of here, you know. And he off he went, like, Monday morning, and he fucking walks. So you were out Friday? He went, oh, yeah, I got home and I fucking did this and I did that. And I thought, I said, you fucking idiot. You fucking crank. Anyway, he walked through and fucking one of the screws went to me. The lying cunt. I said, why? He said, he's fucking found out that her lass has been shagging him out, so he's only got his two-year-old baby swung around and bash her head off the wall.
Oh, no, fucking hell, man.
I said, fucking has he?
Oh, fuck me.
I said, the dirty fucking. I went, he went, no, Vulture. I haven't told you. Just the screw, didn't even know.
Oh, fuck me, that's awful.
So... I got the fucking lads together, I said, you can't be having him on here, like, you know, and this young one was there, he was only 21, he'd just come in, I wished him happy birthday, I think I've told you, haven't I? He used to stand on the twos, and the door would open, and the young one would come through and go, happy birthday, mate, and he'd go, oh, do you know, my mate, it's my birthday, well, I'm fucking psychic, kid, and he'd fucking walk through, and then and he'd wait a bit, and the door opened, and happy birthday, kid. Eh? How do you know it's my birthday? I've just told them that I'm fucking psychic. Another one comes through. The fucking lads laughing the heads off. Well, the crack is, when you're a young offender in the institution,
yeah.
The day you turn 21 is the day you move you to the big house. So, I knew it was the birthday. Fucking hell, I knew it was the birthday, you know what I mean?
Can you imagine that though, being a young one going to prison? He walking and he's looking down. Happy birthday.
How the fuck did he know that? How the fuck's in the scrolls? Oh, the fucking house. Yeah. The scrolls are laughing, you know what I mean? The scrolls know the crap.
Yeah.
You moved on your fucking actual birthday.
Yeah.
The day you turn 21, that day you shipped out. So I knew, you know what I mean?
How intimidating would that
be? Getting back to this young one, he'd been in a couple of weeks. He's from Borough. Didn't know his name. Lovely kid. You know, got on with him and we were talking. He went, Vulture, can I do this one? I said, yeah, if you want, kid, are you up for it? Like, he said, oh, I'm fucking up for it, like. So I said, what are you going to do? He said, you'll see. All right, fair enough. So I said, tomorrow, I said, when they're all coming in from Graft, tomorrow dinner, that'll be the best time because the full fucking wing on the ones is people walking. You know, there's a lot of people there. Screws won't see much.
Yeah.
He went, right, that'll do. So I goes up on the fucking twos and they all start spewing in and I sees the lad come through and then I looks that way and I seen him coming this way. So I walk down the fucking stairs and I just got on the fucking floor and yeah, I heard the fucking scream and he turned round and I went, get the fuck away from me. He got a fucking razor blade. He stuck it in his head and striped him right down. So it went through his head, across his eye, through his nose, through his mouth, off the end of his chin and onto his chest. Deep. Wide open, deep.
Bye.
Fucking wowing, get the fuck away from me. the screws all just ran out, fucking pounced them with towels, wrapped them with towels. He was laid there and he went, spat two teeth out. Oh. It went to his fucking, you know, to his gums.
Mm.
Like, what the fuck?
Yeah, fucking hell, good.
Yeah, well, good. He deserved a cunt for
yeah.
me. Like, but
yeah, down for
I
me.
I thought, what the fuck?
Mm.
Anyway, he fucking walked up the stairs and he winked at me, the young one, like, and I gave him the nod. I thought, fucking hell, that kid hasn't fucked about, like, 21-year-old. Yeah. Fuck, I'm glad I haven't upset the cunt. Yeah. Anyway, he got nicked for it.
Well, not, kid not,
an hour later, we were all in bang up through it. And not an hour later, and then we realised there's more nonces on the wing. They're looking after each other. So I said, this group, somebody's grassed him up. It's not one of the lads. It's a fucking nonce. He went, as though to say, yeah. So I knew. I said, fucking hell, lads, there's loads on here. There's fucking nonces on here. But you couldn't tell who was fucking out. Because, I mean, some nonces you can look and go, yeah.
Yeah.
You can see he's a fucking nonce.
Yeah.
But some of them are just normal fucking people. So you, it was fucking weird because it made me paranoid because I had photographs of me girls and then on me wall and me pad.
Oh, yeah.
And people would come in and go, oh, they're beautiful. Fucking, hey, are my kids. It made you fucking paranoid. Oh, yeah. Vulture, I'm just saying, the lovely kids, you know.
Yeah.
And you're thinking, fuck.
Forever on edge, aren't you?
Yeah.
That's horrible, that.
Yeah, right. Fucking weird old place, volatile.
Mm.
Very fucking, Dedham was fucking very volatile. But, you know, somewhat simple to kick off. Fucking with me, you know, and I would just fucking kick off.
Mm.
Well, fucking hell. You
the
know,
atmosphere is yeah, horrible.
Fucking, it is horrible, I mean, but you get on with it. You try not to upset anybody.
Yeah.
And you hope nobody fucking upsets you.
Yeah,
it's
yeah.
as simple as that, you know yeah. what I mean? It's the way it goes. Like, so you get in your little clicks.
Yeah.
You know, you'll get a little click and, you know, and you'll get chatting with them and stuff. Especially when we're in Dereham. Because when I was in Dereham in 98, I was the only man in the full jail from Hartlepool.
Mm.
I knew kids from Sunderland, Newcastle, you know, the surrounding areas in there that I'd fucking had business with before. Fucking, how you doing, Vulture? How you doing? And they'd come and fucking, when I first went in, sticking gear under me door, fucking phone cards, phone home, Vulture, soon to let you out, get phone your last and the kids.
Yeah.
Backy, they were getting silver foil and putting back in, sleeping and under, were fucking.
So you looked after them?
Oh, fucking
yeah.
proper looked after all the boys, like, fucking Vultures on, Vultures here.
Yeah.
You know, they were all shouting out the windows, Vultures here, man, he's on the fucking twos. Fucking sort them somewhat out, lads, all that sort, and there was fucking all sorts coming under the door.
That must have made your time a little bit easier.
Of course it does, you know, and it's like, you get out in association, the first time on association, and I got to pick the phone up the same day I'd been jailed.
Mm.
And I fucking, well, that's fucking hell. You know, have you managed the phone? I said, the fucking lads in here, man's proper looking after us.
Yeah.
Backy, I've got backy, I've got fucking phone cards, I've got fucking, you know, them coming, my fucking, one come with a bag, there was fucking a bottle of orange squash in, biscuits, fucking Kit Kats, they were fucking all clipping together and they had Vulture, mate. Mm.
You know, absolutely, the respect you've earned for your fucking.
Well, not only that, they were fucking proper good lads, and they know how hard it is when you first go into jail.
Yeah.
You've got fuck all, you have nothing, you treat like everyone else. Doesn't matter who you fucking are and what you've done.
Yeah.
You're the same as every cunt else.
Mm.
So for me, them doing that, I mean, and it means so much, like a bottle of squash.
Yeah.
Because all you've got is fucking tap water.
Mm.
And you mentioned a bottle of squash and stuff like that, it makes a fucking difference, you know.
We were worrying about this before, when we said even the daftest little thing, like a fucking letter.
A letter?
You know, it's so welcoming. And
you know, if you don't get a letter on a day, I'd be fucking like, why haven't I got a fucking letter? It'd make me angry, you know what I mean?
Yeah,
so
yeah.
I imagine it was the same with everyone.
Mm.
You know, but not me now. Well, my lass had fucking four kids to look after. You know, she couldn't.
Yeah.
She couldn't write a fucking letter every day. She tried, you know what I mean?
But
she started getting the kids to do it. you know, like drawing daft pictures and then, you know, writing, scribbling.
Little stickmen and
things. Yeah,
that done me.
I had them all up my fucking walls in my pad, you know what I mean? Yeah. It was fucking mint.
Proper a smile on your face, that as well.
It was good, Yeah, it was good, like, to fucking, you know, the lads to look after you and to get them off the kids and that, it made a fucking big difference. I mean, the normal people on the out, you know, a kid will draw the mum or dad a picture and they go, oh yeah, that's nice.
Yeah.
And that's the end of it. In there, it's like, fuck.
It means so much, so much.
Knowing your fucking bands took the time to do that for you, and you know what I mean? And they've posted it.
Saving later on your bed, you'll be looking at it like
you look at them, you look at them and you think, you know, fucking mint.
Oh, good stuff.
If you have a shit day or something, you can concentrate on
just looking at them. That's right.
It's a slow, right, but we're coming to the end of your prison sentence now. Say we're coming out. How was that like, your parole and that?
Yeah, I went on some courses and stuff. Mm. You know, there was an oldest guy in there. And he said, I'll tell you what you do, Vulture. You do everything they fucking say. You go on as many courses as you can.
Mm-hmm.
And you keep your head down.
Yeah.
I said, fucking thank you, good advice, you know what I mean? So that's basically what I did. They put me in a problem solving course. I think it was 20 odd grand on the out to do.
Yeah.
You know, if you're outside, you wanted to be, It lasted 6 months. And it was like, it was all about, it was good actually. It was about like thinking before you act.
Mm.
You know, every action has a reaction.
Yeah.
You know, if you do something good in life or bad in life, it has a fucking consequence. If you do good, it'll have a good consequence. If you do bad, it'll have a bad consequence.
Mm-hmm.
Kids weren't thinking like that, you know, and it made me realise, fucking hell, yeah, think before you do something.
Yeah.
Think about, you know, if I do this, what's going to happen?
Yeah, that butterfly effect.
Yeah. Mm. You know, it was daft things like that. Then they had, like, they told us to get a piece of paper, line down the middle, line across the top, good, bad. Think of a situation. So you think, right, I've got a job, but I'm getting a new job. So you'd go, right, what's good and what's bad? So, well, it's good, it's more money. Bad, it's more hours. So you would, and you'd leave the sheet, and I had our last doing it at home years later. Yeah, and it works. I had the kids doing it. The kids would go, Dad, I don't know what to do here. And I'd say, right, do this. And over 2 or 3 days, you look at it, and it's either good or bad.
Yeah.
And you can, that tells you instantly what you should be doing.
That's good, that.
Yeah, that it's really good. Clever, you know what I mean, how they did it. And I've used it myself since.
Yeah.
And I've told my kids to use it when they were younger. And they'll come to me and say, Daddy, it's worked. Yeah, I know what I want to do now.
Yeah.
You know, because it outweighs itself.
Well, the more you sum think, it up, can you?
Yeah, you're weighing it up. You're weighing it up, you know.
That's good.
You think of every fucking possible thing you can about that scenario and what you're going to do. Is it going to be good? Is it going to be bad? You know, more money. I'll be getting less money. That's bad, you know what I mean? More money's good. So it weighs it. And then all of a sudden, and all of a sudden you go, one's outweighing the other.
Yeah, and that's that one, yeah.
It's that one, the one with it, you know.
Fucking good, that.
I think I sat using that tactic myself.
Honest to God, it really, really does work, like. It really does work.
That's really good.
You know, so I went on all the fucking courses. You know, did everything that was fucking asked of me. I did like a fucking joint in jail, you know, which I shouldn't have. Because I was up for my parole and that. And I thought, fucking hell, if I get fucking piss tested here, that's me, I'm fucked, I've got another year to do. On top of the 3 year of fucking, you know what I mean?
Yeah.
So I thought, there's fucking, what am I doing? There's this fucking like container, I think it was like a mint container with a lid, like a snap off lid. So I thought, fucking here. Do you take drugs? No, I'm fucking clean as fuck, me, Vulture, pissing that for us. So I'd fucking piss in it, and I'd put it between the cheeks of my ass and go to sleep, because I knew they were coming. And after a couple of days, I thought, that'd be no good. I poured the cum down, I said, you're pissing it again. A couple of days later, nothing. Poured that out, pissing it again. Next thing you know, bang, 4 o'clock, the door opens. Piss test. Things between the cheeks of my ass, you know what I mean? So I goes down, puts me clothes on. Goes down, puts me in this little room with a fucking little cup thing. So I just reached under, poured it in, and come back in. There you go, gents. All right, no problem. Labelled it all up, took it away, come back, negative. Fucking yes.
That was you, what?
That was me fucking, I'm getting me parole.
Yes.
So I was in fucking Northumberland jail. It's called Northumberland now. It was called Acklinton then. But yeah. We called it Smacklinton. For obvious reasons.
Yeah.
So this screw walks along the landing and he looks at me and he went, "You know summit, Pounder." I said, "What?" He went, 15 years I've been in this jail." He said, "For 15 years, not one person off this wing has ever had parole." He went, "Parole granted."
Yeah.
Fucking yes.
Oh,
he went.
Man.
He said, "How the fuck you done that? How have you done that?" I said, "I'm not as daft as what you look, mate." That's what he did, started laughing. I thought, "You fucking idiot, I've just insulted you." You know? Fucking beauty. "I'm not as daft as what you look, pal." He started laughing. Fucking hell, I've insulted you, you know.
Yeah, I see.
He's over the moment. I was out in 5 weeks' time.
No, oh, brilliant.
I thought, fucking jackpot.
Yeah. So you released
but a lot,
it.
Lee Pennick had a lot to do with it. You know Lee Pennick?
But then Alec Paul.
He's a chef. He's a cracking chef.
Yeah. Or did he have the Douglas? No, that's right. In the Douglas Hotel.
Yeah, he had the Douglas at one point. Yeah, yeah, he had. He's had fucking loads of them.
Yeah.
You know,
yeah.
He's had loads. He's on the marina on the that little fish bar. I forget the name of it now.
Yeah.
He's doing breakfast and as well as the fish shop. He's doing really well. Like.
Oh, good stuff.
He's a good pal. He went and got me. He went to, I think it was Hartlepool United and got me a job as a groundsman.
Oh, very poor, very good, eh?
That went a long way with parole.
Did it?
That went in my parole thing that I had a job ready to go out to and that.
Yeah.
You know, so he helped me out a lot that way, you know. And other lads did, you know what I mean? Yeah. Like putting things in, saying there's a job here for him and, you know.
Yeah, good stuff.
You know, and the rest fucking history. I've never been back. I got out. I think O'Connor was about 18 months, my youngest son. And when I got out, he was fucking high on 5.
Yeah.
That's a fucking long time, you know what I mean? Yeah. And it's like...
It is, especially with kids.
The first night, I remember going up the fucking stairs, going in the bedroom, started to take my clothes up, and he went, "What are you doing?" I said, "I'm getting in bed, son." He said, "Who with?" I said, "Your mum?" He went, "No, you're not like." I said, "Excuse me." "No, you're not like. I sleep there." I said, "Do you?" I said, "Not anymore, mate. I sleep there." I said, "Believe me, I'm a lot bigger and a lot fucking tougher than you." You know. So I think we spent a week with him sleeping in between them, you know.
That's fresh out of jail as well.
You know, like, just so he can get used to us, yeah, you know. Yeah. He couldn't work it out.
Yeah.
Watch me fucking wise me then getting in there,
yeah.
You know.
Yeah, while you were gone, man, there's a new man in the house now.
Yeah, yeah. But, you know, I've told you about this.
Yeah.
I didn't know I was fucking doing it, you know. I would, she'd say to me, "Will you sit down?" I was fucking going to the fridge. Opening the fridge.
Oh, this is out as you come out of jail.
Yeah, after I come out of jail, I was looking at in the fridge, shutting it, walking away. 2 minutes later, I didn't even know I was doing it. I was going to the fridge, opening the fridge. She said, "What the fuck are you doing that for?" I said, "I don't know. I didn't even realise I was doing it because I've never seen a fridge. I've never had cold milk."
Mm.
Yeah.
For fucking for years.
You were saying about your first taste of the milk, were you?
Fucking. Oh, you want to get down to fucking brain freeze. I fucking necked the full pint and I got the fucking bra. Man, that is fucking mint.
Yeah.
But what I found, we went to the town, I was only out a couple of days. We went to the fucking town and we got to the crossing, pressed the button, and it went beep, 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 and everyone was gone. And I was still like, what the fuck? Because in jail, this is the pace, that's it.
Yeah.
There's no faster than that. Everything works on that pace. So when you get out, the day I got out, my pal picked us up, we gets on the A1, "Fucking slow down, slow down." He went, "I'm only doing 50. I went, "Fucking hell, you're half." I think I was doing 120, 30 mile an hour. You know, because I hadn't experienced speed for that many years.
Yeah.
I'm thinking, fucking hell, slow down, slow down. I want to see me wife and fucking kids, you know what I mean?
Mate.
Weird, like,
yeah.
Crossings.
You mentioned that the marina wasn't built as well.
All the marina had been fucking built while I was there.
Yeah, yeah.
You know, Lancaster Road was the fucking road I used to go along then.
Yeah.
It was the main road in the town. And when that lass took me down, I was like, what the fuck? Where's all this come from?
Yeah, that's mad.
Crazy.
Yeah, that's crazy.
When I had Mick Sorby on, he said the same. It's the same way when he said it, when I got released.
He's done a lot longer than me, Mick.
He said it was the noise.
Noise.
He said, I couldn't get used to the fucking noise.
Yeah, noise and like that things.
Yeah.
I mean, fucking hell, on my way home, you know. My pal, Gary Dixon, he had the Saxon pub. Saxon pub was there. So, fucking pull in. So he fucking pulls in, like, fucking how you doing? Do you want a pint? I said, no, give a half. So I got a fucking half and I went, oh, that's fucking lovely. So I sit me on the fucking hand and I finished it. And we're sitting talking, fucking words up of half a beer. I went, fucking hell, what was that? What was in it? She said, just half a fucking lager. I went, fucking, for fucking hell.
That's mad.
And before I went to jail, I had a fucking lovely Caffrey's Irish Ale.
Yeah.
I loved the stuff because I used to go fishing at Scotland in this bar called the Smuggler's Arms.
Right.
It was a beautiful bar. It was obviously to do with smugglers and stuff over there, yeah. You know. And the bar was built out of a boat, an old boat, you know. It was a fucking beautiful place, country pub. So when we got time, I'd go up and have a couple of pints of fucking just Caffrey's Irish Ale.
Mm.
And it was fucking outstanding.
Yeah.
So I gets out of fucking jail. And went in the supermarket, we're about, I don't know, a couple of weeks out. And I fucking looks and you could only get it in Scotland on draft. Fucking hell, they're doing it in tins, Leslie. I've never had that for years. Get a fucking tray. So we got a tray and I put some in the fridge. And on the night, I thought, I won't have a Caffrey's Irish Ale. So I went what the fuck is that shit? You know what I mean? It was fucking vile. Honest mate, I poured the fucking lot down, the full fucking tray away. I'll never drink that fucking stuff again. It's like an acquired taste, you know, when you're like, fucking get rid of that. I'm not drinking that bastard, you know what I mean?
Oh, come back. So you mean say you're out of jail and that now, you sort of never really went back to that sort of thing, did you, Walsh?
Nah, I mean, nah, it was no longer interested me, mate. It was like too long away.
Missing the kids a lot.
Yeah, I mean, yeah. I thought, no, every sentence I'm going to get's going to be years. It's not going to be fucking months no more because of what I was doing. You know, it was like, I couldn't go back to fucking selling large amounts of fucking drugs and that, because it's a lot of averages. You know, I've seen lads do it. They fucking, they'll get 15 years, they'll get out, they're out fucking 6-7 months, and they get another 15. I've seen it, you know what I mean?
That's what we keep an eye on,
Of course, yeah.
No, that's it, it's on top of you now as well, isn't it? Once you've been flagged.
I mean, I nearly went once. You know, I nearly got fucking jailed once. Me and Richie Hughes, a kid called Richie Hughes, who owns Ultimate Security in Hartlepool. A friend of ours, they were having trouble with his family, so they sent a load of lads with fucking machetes to the house and chopped all the fucking cars up, and then he'd chop their lass up on the doorstep back, so if you were looking, he had the door shut.
Wow.
And I know the kids, and I know the kids would have chopped her, like. Anyway, they sent me to the house that had been chopped up. Will you do us a favour? Will you go and say to them, that's the fucking end of it now. Well, this is going to happen, that's going to happen. So I said, right, so it was like afternoon, early afternoon, so me and Richie went. I knocked on the door, he opened the door, he went, fucking hell, Vulture. I went, listen, I shook his hand, I said, I just need a quick word with you. He said, come through. So we went through, we sat down. I told him how it was. This is how it's going to happen. And if you don't like it, fucking basically move town, move out.
Mm-hmm.
Right, no problem. Shook his hand on the way out. T9, boom, fucking doors in. Fucking busies everywhere. I said, oh, Connor, do me a favour, mate. Count how many policemen are in my house. He went, he come back, he went, Dad, there's 33.
Fuck, mate.
I went, what the fuck's going on here? What's going on here? You know, thinking in my head, what the fuck's going on here? What the fucking hell's going on here? And I done out. I thought, I've done out, so I thought, I'm all right, I'm all right. I've done now, you know what I mean? Like, you can't, you know, they can't fucking send me to jail for something I haven't done, you know, I've never done fuck all. So the locks us up, takes her down the station. As I'm going through, I'm saying, fucking Richie in the busy station, I thought, I know what it is, that house we went out today. So they get us in there, and it's fucking, it's only about 10 years ago, this.
Mm.
And the fucking goes into the interview, my solicitor, and I just, no comment, no comment, no comment, no comment. Like I was done, Richie done the same, no comment, no comment, no comment, no comment. Came out in the cells, solicitor called us out, they put you in a room on your own, police are not allowed to listen. Put us in a room on our own, he said, they've got video and audio in the house. I said, what do you mean? He went, when the house got chopped up, they sent them to fucking video inside the house and audio inside the house. And when you're shitting me, he said, what are you, fucking hell. So he said, wait, lad, he's a fucking cracking solicitor, Neil Taylor. He's a fucking, honest to God, mate, he is fucking spot on. Like, he said, no comment it till I find out more. So we went, another interview, no comment, no comment, no comment. And took us back, he came back and he went, that's what the money went, they've got video but the audio didn't work. He said, so basically Vulture, all they've got is you shaking his hand on the way in, sitting down chatting, shaking his hand on the way out.
Mm.
Where's the threat there?
Yeah, yeah.
No comment, all the fucking way. God. He went and told Richie the same. So I just sat and laughed at them.
Oh, mate.
I didn't even say no comment, you know what I did? I laughed at them, put my head on the table like that, went to sleep. Just can't even ask the questions, I just fucking ignored them. Fucking knobheads, you got now, you know what I mean?
That was your last little taste of belly.
Yeah, yeah, that was my last fucking taste, and I thought,
yeah,
fucking hell, even I'm going back to my old fucking self again, man. I'm threatening people and...
Yeah, yeah. You know, you've been doing a bit of straight and narrow now, and you've done a lot for charity since you've been out and got, you know.
Yeah, you know, I mean, the last one I did, I think was the last one. No, it might not have been, to be truthful. I don't keep counting on them, I just do it, you know what I mean?
Yeah.
I know my daughter caught, when the fucking first lockdown, my daughter, you know, I've got my older daughter, Nadine, she's a single mum, but she still gets on with her fella. And he, you know, he helps out, you know, he's working away at the minute. But when he's home, he sorts it out with the bairn, he's buying Christmas friends. He's a lovely kid, Dylan. I've got our Jessica lives in Stockton with Danny. He's a cracking lad and all. She's a nurse in their noughties.
Yeah.
I've got our Carlita. Carlita, she's a district nurse.
Mm-hmm.
And then I've got our Connor. He's just basically a fucking nightmare.
he's a chip off the old block, is he?
He's a chip off the old block, but he's a cracking kid, honest to God. Yeah. Everyone says to me, fucking hell, he's a credit to you, mate.
Yeah.
He's 24 year old.
Yeah.
He just wants to stay off motorbikes. He's fucking, you know what I mean? He keeps hurting himself badly. Like, well, that's another story.
Yeah, definitely, mate.
So anyway, my third daughter, Carlita, she's a district nurse, and she'd contacted the fucking virus.
Mm.
What happened was, you panic, don't you, because you don't know what's going to happen. So there's all this fucking on the news, people, thousands and thousands are dying. So I said to everyone, right, you're all moving back into mine.
Mm-hmm.
We all staying under one roof. I'll do the fucking shop and I'll do the fucking this and I'll do that. Because I was still out doing a bit.
Mm.
And there were some lads working in the town and round Dyke House area, and they were attacked and all the tools took off, the mum was put in hospital and stuff. So they'd pay me 150 quid a day to sit in the car and watch them dig holes.
Mm.
I sit there all fucking day, you know, not a problem.
Yeah.
So I boxed that off, so I was still going out because they were classed as key workers because they were putting all the electrics into the house and stuff.
Yeah.
So I said, there's no point anyone else going out, I can do it.
Yeah.
You know, while I'm at work, I nip the fuck, nobody was bothering them once I knew I was on the job.
Yeah, yeah.
Now the thieves were pulling up, saying me and going, fuck, I'm just taking off, you know what I mean? Mm. Once word got round, I didn't even need to be there, to be truthful. I just went.
Yeah.
So I moved them all back in. I'm Nadine with the bairn. Our Connor, their lass Beth, she's lovely and all, she's like a daughter. And our La Rosa, Mamie, granddaughter.
Yeah.
They've just had twins, actually, Charles and Chester, identical twins.
Man.
Fucking hellish, man. Yeah. I wouldn't have called them Roger and Rennie, but they wouldn't let me. Instead of Ronnie and Reggie. Roger and Rennie. So anyway, I moved them in, and I don't know what happened, you know, but we were lucky. Carly said, well, look, why don't I move into Connor's house with my boyfriend? Another lovely kid, you know. So we said, well, yeah. She said, well, that'll give you more room. I'll give you more room. And I said, oh, yeah, well, yeah. So she moved down there. Mm. 2 days later, she phoned us, I've got the COVID. Now, if she'd have come home, she'd have given us all it, probably,
yeah,
you know.
Yeah.
So I locked us all down. Nobody left the fucking house for about 6 weeks, you know what I mean?
What was that like? Everyone climbed over each other?
No, it was fucking brilliant.
Yeah.
You know, you had the grandparents there, you know, you got your kids there, you know, and it was fucking great.
Yeah.
There was only our Jessica who lived in Stockton, see, with Annie, but she was working on the COVID ward. She never got it. Working on the COVID
ward. It's mad, that, isn't it?
Time. Yeah, yeah.
Absolutely mental.
And our Carly got the COVID really bad. Like, she said, Dad, at one point, her phone was on the bedside, it was on vibrate, she was dozing, and it went off, and it was like a million fucking pins in her head. She said, I just woke up screaming, like, I want the phone to stop, and it was only vibrating. She said, it's the worst thing I've ever went through, like.
That is mental. This COVID just giving people a different...
Yeah, it's a different way all it is, yeah.
It's strange.
So, our Jessica, and she's a nurse, she was working on the COVID ward, and she phoned me up upset. What's the matter, kid? And I said, Dad, I'm just fucking sick. She said, I'm holding people's hands and they're dying, asking for the family, and they can't see the family. She said, when I come out to work, there's kids playing fucking football, and there's people talking to each other at the shops, like there's fucking nothing going on. Mm. She said, it's like, I can't work it out. I said, well, it is what it is, kid. You just got to get on with it, you know what I mean?
Yeah.
So after our Carly got better and that, I was talking to our Jessica and I said to her, oh, why aren't the fucking, why, you know, and tablets? There is none.
Mm-hmm.
But there's no iPads or fuck all like that. She went, no, you got like old people in there, wouldn't have to fucking use them. Mm-hmm. You know. So I got on to Carly. I said, hey, Carly. I said, fancy, should we raise a few quid like between us? She went, yeah, what for? And I told her, she went, I think it's a fucking excellent idea.
Yeah, yeah, good.
So I got on Facebook. I said to her, get on Facebook. I said, I got on. I said, right, ever so many people dying every fucking day, COVID. I said, nobody's getting to see the family. They're dying on their own.
Mm.
I said, what I want to do, and with our car leader, we want to raise as much money as we can to buy iPods for Northeast General Hospital.
Mm.
So I said, anybody with any second-hand ones, if they want to donate them,
mm,
please do, because they'll do and all, you know. The next thing I know, fucking hell, I was in India, mate. They were coming to the door, here.
Wow, brilliant. That's class, that.
Then the money was piling into a GoFundMe page.
Oh, yeah.
That reached over £5,000.
Fuck me.
So this guy came forward to say, I'll do, because it's just, like, for the hospitals, it's fucking...
Yeah.
So he done all the fucking carry on.
All the admin side of it.
Yeah, he done all that for us for free, you know, each one. And we just shipped them to the fucking hospital. And what they did, which I thought was great, you know, rather than just give them and people being at home, they done this big room up downstairs in the hospital. And it was all sanitised. And they had a computer screen, computer screen. So you'd go and have your visit, sit down and talk to your loved one in the bed on the carry-on.
Oh, in that class.
Yeah, and they were fucking over the made up. They were made up, you know. Like I said, I know it's not the intimate way you can hold them and say your goodbyes.
Yeah, but it's something.
It's something. Yeah, it's fucking something.
Yeah.
You know, rather than sitting at home and then you get the phone call to be in an hospital 2 weeks and have died and you're like, I never got to say bye, and I never, you know.
No, you could have made loads of people, maybe.
I hope you have.
Smile. Because
I didn't only want them on the COVID ward, I wanted them on every ward, because nobody was allowed to visit.
Yeah.
Nobody. And it made such a difference.
You get to see the face,
That's right, you're getting some kind of closure.
Yeah.
Some kind of closure, you know, that was the idea.
I respect you.
No problems, mate. No problems, yeah.
Right, so
watched this story has been absolutely incredible. I've loved every minute of it. But before you go, I've got to ask this story, mate, because I've had so much feedback of this story because we put it on the promo, and I think we've got to tell it. So what I'm going to say to you is now, sit back, get the popcorn out, get the Budweiser out, turn Netflix off, put this on the big telly and listen to this. Right, Bulge, there's a story, a rumour, what you're allegedly supposed to have done about something about an open prison. All right, I heard rumours, and these are rumours, by the way, that you broke into an open prison. So I've asked, loads of people have asked me about the story, so you've got to say it before we go. Go on, tell us what happened, what the rumours were.
True. True, rumours are true, yeah.
Bloody mad.
I can give you the phone number of a guy who's with us now.
Yeah.
And he'll tell you.
Yeah, bloody hell.
So, I broke into a prison
because
a man owed me money. And I wasn't letting him get away with it.
That's mental.
So I put him in hospital.
That is mental. That is mental. I don't know if you wanted to go.
See, I'll go into detail.
Yeah.
You know, people think, oh, fucking hell, prison, fucking razor wire, fucking walls, all that. It wasn't, it was an open prison.
Right.
So you've got a couple of three fences to get over with a bit of barbed wire. You know, I think it was fucking a couple of ploughed fucking fields with potatoes in and that kind of thing. And there was three of us. We got in, I wanted to link it up.
Yeah.
So I was right down the road, this mind. It was fucking hell, it was about 3 hours fucking drive for us. It was my birthday. And I was fucking pissed. You know, when he'd been pissed up. We went back to my house and I said, what do you want to do? I said, well, that come from Sheffield. I said, I'll probably never see him again. I said, so I want to break into the fucking prison and I want to fucking hurt him. And they were like, you're fucking shitting me.
Yeah.
Nah.
Mm.
Nah.
No way you could do it.
I'm not fucking shitting you at all. So we drove down, we broke in, and I knew a lad in there. There was a guy walking round from the showers, and I went, shh, shh, shh. And he went, I said, and I told him the man's name. I said, where is he? He said, he's from the Vulture. He was a pal of mine. So I went in and seen him. I gave him some baccy. We took him a load of baccy. Fucking good fella he was. He's sadly no longer with us, you know what I mean? Mm-hmm. He was a good friend. He was a good friend. The family, you know what I mean?
Yeah.
I'm not going to say his name.
Yeah, no.
You know, and I gave him a load of fucking baccy. He was over the moon. I said, where's that cunt at? I want that Sheffield boy. He said, he's down there with the lifers. He told me the which room to go to. So no problem. And as we came out, the fucking door opened. I said, on the side, we stood at the side there, and two screws walked straight past us. So my pal said it was later on. Or if that had come on top, and I said, I'd have knocked the fucking pair of them clean. And off we'd have went.
Yeah.
The fuck out of Dodge, you know what I mean?
Yeah.
So these two are fucking sort of panicky, you know what I mean? They're not villains, if you know what I mean. So we fucking on, I gets in this fucking, I goes down and he opens a fucking door because an open prison's a lot locked, you know what I mean?
Mm.
So I fucking opens the door and I looks at the guy on the top bunk and he opened his eyes. I went, shh, go back to sleep. And he just shut his eyes. He thought, fucking hell, what's going on here? So the cunt pulled the covers back, he opened his eyes and he smiled at me. I said, what do you think you're fucking dreaming, you fucking idiot? He fucking look of terror on his face. I said, you fucking you're out of bed, fucking smashed him to fucking bits, chair on his fucking head. You dirty, horrible cunt, you fucking ripped me off. It was quite a few grand, you know what I mean? I was fucking out. He wasn't in a way with it.
That's a fucking no way to do it, like, isn't it?
No way was he getting fucking away with it anyway. Yeah. We fucked off. I'd done enough damage. The lads went Vulture. That's enough, you know what I mean? We fucked off. We got out, went home, got a phone call the next day off a pal. to say, fucking hell, you put him in hospital, he's fucking bad, like.
Fuck me.
I think fucking a shitload of his teeth were gone.
Wow.
His jaw was broke, his fractured cheekbone. I broke all, broke all his fingers when he was going like that to stop me hitting him over the head with a chair.
That is a fucking stuff of legend.
I was really over the moon when he said, fucking hell, he's due out tomorrow. They kept him another 6 weeks. Oh, no, that'll fucking do you, prick.
I'll
yeah.
teach you.
I'll fucking teach you, yeah.
That is,
many, many moons ago, that.
You know what, mate? When we say we've done the promo, I had to mention that story.
I know.
Everyone was fucking...
I wasn't going to tell it, but... Yeah. Yeah, what the fuck?
How you say, allegedly rumours.
Yeah, they say it's rumours, isn't it?
Yeah, rumours.
I'll say it's a rumour. Yeah, there's a rumour.
Well, listen, my mates, we're on that note now, and it's pretty sad because I have absolutely enjoyed this. It's been,
yeah, it's been
absolute
good.
Privilege having
it's
you.
It's been good. It's like,
yeah,
you know, I've been asked to do things like this for years, and
yeah.
I was never fucking ever interested.
Never fancied it.
Never fancied. Richie said to me for years, get something done, get a book, and you know, do this and that. I'm like, I'm a fucking interested man.
Yeah, yeah.
To be truthful, I thought, I'm ashamed of half of what I've fucking done, you know what I mean? I'm ashamed of half of what I've done, but then I think I've done some fucking good things, you know?
Yeah, exactly.
Like...
You see, what you've
like
done...
We had West fucking View, was fucking plagued with fucking smackhead, fucking thieving, horrible bastards. I put a stop to that. There were robbing old people, taking, you know, bedridden, taking their wedding rings up the fingers, old, really old people, treasured fucking things, DVD players up the fucking bedsides and that. And it fucking really, really did boil my piss.
Come the earth off.
I pushed my cap for a while and I thought, I'm not having this. So I just started going around kidnapping the cunts and smashing them to bits.
A vigilante spree sort of thing.
Yeah, I went on a fucking vigilante spree that lasted fucking years.
I had to shake your hand on that, was hard to speculate.
Honest to God,
well,
fucking I was sick to fucking death of the phone ringing. Fucking hell, so-and-so's been robbed in the sleep and you're thinking horrible dirty bastards.
Yeah.
I thought, well, let's clean the fucking place up.
Yeah, good
so,
on you, mate.
So I sort of cleaned the place up. I mean, it's still bad. You know, I don't do it now, but fucking at the time I cleaned the place up like...
Yeah, good on you.
You know, I've lived in my street 30 years. There's never been a car touched, a fucking... An house burgled.
That is mad.
There'd been nothing.
That's good, Dad.
Every fucking thief in Hartlepool and the surrounding areas stays away from my street. It's as simple as that.
I love that, mate. That's fantastic.
Yeah.
Really good, mate.
Yeah.
Like you say, my mate, what shame we're coming to end was I have absolutely... But
listen,
before I do go...
Listen,
but,
I've got a fucking thousand other stories I can tell. So
I'm going to get you back on for a part two.
Let's see what the future brings, yeah.
But one thing I do know, Vulture, is now you've done this podcast and a few people have seen your promos, and I know we haven't seen the last few on the social media. I know already there's been interest in people wanting to write your books.
Yeah.
You're going on the podcast on the big lads.
I'm going, yeah.
On Out the Woods.
Yeah.
The Woods, I mean, he's up there with he's the best, one of the best of the Woods. Dick Eggie's going
on. Dick and Eggie's asked for me to come on and all, apparently, so...
But I did get the exclusive, though.
You did. Like, I wanted you to have the exclusive.
Thank you, mate.
You know, I've not long known, I've only knew you fucking what a week.
Yeah.
I feel like I've knew you all my
life. It's the same. We text each other every day.
All time, yeah. We're constantly at it, and it's, I hope that continues. You
I
know
hope
know
so,
mean?
Mate, yeah. I hope this leads on to the next chapter in your life, my mate, and... takes off
if it doesn't, I'm not really bothered to be truthful me. You know, it's never really, like I said, it's never really bothered me.
Yeah.
But I'll go along with it, see what it does, you know what I mean? What I don't like is all this podcast wars. It's like...
It's
politics and I don't want to get in. I'm not calling anybody because I know them all and I get on with all of them.
Yeah.
You know, so I like to keep it that fucking
that's
way.
Fair.
I'm not either slate no one or call no one. Or,
well, that's the same what we want... We're out there set to do.
Yeah.
I mean, there's some great podcasters out there, Out the Woods.
Yeah.
These are all really, really like, we're not out to cause any bother around
No,
there.
No, that, exactly.
Yeah, we just
want to
hear great
this,
stories.
You want to hear the stories,
yeah.
And that's the end of it. You want people sitting at home going, fucking hell.
What a good show that was,
you know, and I hope people laughed. I hope people.
I think they will,
you know.
Yeah.
you know, I hope people, you know, because I like to have a laugh along the way, you know what I mean? I think it's well, important, you know what I mean?
But see, I said this earlier on, when you tell the story, when you first met, straight away, I said to Lit, I said, when Vulch tells a story, it's fucking captivating. I said, it's one of them I could sit and listen for hours. I said, when he tells a story, you actually feel like you're there with him. Yeah. I'm sure the viewers back are watching this, I'll say the same.
I hope so.
Definitely. But once again, my mates, I'm all the money you come on. It's been absolute pleasure to meet you.
And it's been fantastic.
Enjoy, pal. I really have enjoyed it.
And like you say, there might be a second fucking album for us, where?
Yeah, well, I will have to do a part two, mate. Yeah. We'll have to, definitely. Oh, before I go as well, I'd like to say a massive thank you to Steve Cotson from the Lab Gym. There we go.
Nice one, Steve.
For sponsoring the show. He's a great bloke. I'll put his link in the description below and his email address, phone number, if you want to get in touch with him.
Can I say something about Steve?
Of course.
He's a true gentleman.
Yeah.
Now, I remember going to the gym. He was 15 years old and he was grappling on the floor and he was fucking throwing funny grown men around at 15 years old. He's fucking awesome, by the way.
He's clued up with his hair.
Fucking what a martial artist. Honest to God, he is. Proper and a gentleman.
A nice guy.
A pure gentleman.
Nice guy. So a big shout out to Steve. You're doing a fantastic job at the Lab Gym, my mate. And another shout out for me editor, Lit. How are you coming here, Lit? Put your face and say hello.
Put your face in, Lit.
Get back over there. But thanks very much for Lit.
Oh, my podcast.
He's absolute diamond for coming on, helping us out. And it's been, once again, Vulture. Thank you for coming on. I really enjoyed it, my mate. You're a good one.
Yeah, enjoyed it, my mate.
So thanks, everyone. If you enjoyed the video, hit the subscribe. Keep an eye out for the next ones. And take care, everybody. Okay.